Man. What's up, guys? We're here. We're live. Welcome to a brand new Poker Life podcast. My name is Jose Ingram, one aka Chicago Joey, joined today by a man who can talk about sushi for 79 hours straight without sleeping, eating, or drinking anything. He is one of the favorite podcast guests we get to have on, and his name is Donnie Stern, aka Ansky, aka Supernova 9 on Poker Stars. What's up, Donnie? Welcome to the podcast.
What's up, Joey? Thanks for getting the name right on the first try this time.
So, do you want to know what I've been doing to prepare for your name?
What have you been doing?
I've been walking around today, and I've been saying, Donnie Stern, Donnie Stern, Donnie. Because last time I was like, Danny, you're like, no, dude, chill, it's Donnie. I'm like, all right, Donnie, all right, all right.
Yeah, it's a common thing, so don't feel too bad about it.
All right, guys, we're here. We are live. We're on Twitch. We're on YouTube. Any comments, questions, bring them in the chat. I don't know if we're drinking whiskey today. I just got back from the gym, and I want to say this at the beginning of the podcast. If for some reason you play sports and you're not performing as good as you want to, stretch. And don't do that bullshit five-minute stretch. Do 30 minutes of stretching. It just unlocks your body. It unlocks your soul. You feel so good. You're moving so well. And that's what I got to get that out of the way. I got to, because the people, they just sometimes watch 5 minutes and then they shower the podcast. So that's all I just want to get that started out of the way. So, but Donnie, we got a lot to talk about with you, kid.
Let's do it. I'm ready.
All right. I'm going to give a little preview. I'm trying to become more GTO at these, what we're going to talk about here. So we have, what do we have? Let me start back here. So we got World Series of Poker Cash Games to discuss. We got Barcelona Shuffle to discuss. We have a lot of high stakes PLO action, a lot of Isildur, Phil Ivey, allegedly. I had something else. Sushi, GTO, whiskey, GTO. Let's just get into it, man. What do you think? What's like the big thing? I guess Barcelona Shuffle was a pretty big thing that happened with you, right? Do you want to get that out of the way first just to address it and then get over it?
Yeah. You want me to like tell the story or what?
All right. Let's tell the story. Tell a quick story about the Barcelona Shuffle for real. Cause like it was pretty popular in poker for like a week or two, but then it sort of got showered, you know, J-Mo thing happened and so it sort of like lost the momentum there for a little bit, but it was a pretty ridiculous story.
Yeah, I mean, it lost momentum also because, you know, I said what I had to say, and that was it, really. Like, there's nothing to be done.
Yeah.
You know, what happened, and that's kind of the end of it. But for those who didn't follow, this is what happened. I was in Barcelona for the EPT, for the Poker Stars EPT Barcelona, and I was playing my first cash game session of the trip, and we're playing 100-200 PLO, and we get into this hand where basically there's two limpers, I pot with kings, some king-king hand, two players call, big blind repots, limpers fold, I call, all the other guys call, so it took four way to the flop. So it was like, I'm going to look at the actual hand. So the pot going into the flop was like 24K, right?
Okay.
And the flop is king 9-7 with a flush draw, so I have top set.
Just top set, huh? Okay.
Yeah, just top set in a massive four way through a pot. What's it like? So sick life, great hand, right?
Without top set on this flop and a four-way pot pre-flop, you know, we wouldn't be able to tell the story right now.
Yeah, of course. Oh, believe me, I would much rather the flop have just been ace high and he bets and I fold.
Okay, let's go.
It's king 9-7 with a flush draw. Small blind, who's Belitos. He checks. The big blind, who's the three better, is this like older Spanish guy. I don't really know who he is. He shoves for around 10K. I shove for my 40K, and Yuha had me covered, and he folded. And then Belitos calls all in.
Belitos check calls all in there? He didn't 3-bet. The old guy 3-bet, right?
Yeah, why are you so surprised?
I thought Belitos 3-bet preflop and then didn't
on the flop. Belitos wasn't the 3-better. Belitos was the flatter. He flatted the first open and then flatted again.
Okay.
Anyway. So the three of us get it all in, and Belitos had like 4 or 5K. So we each put 4 or 5K into the main pot, and there's a side pot of like 10K. And we stop the deal. Like, we don't let the dealer deal the turn. We talk about it. We say we're going to deal it twice. The Spanish guy who doesn't speak much English, but we clearly like, you know, we know that there's a language barrier. We're like, we're running it twice for the whole pot, two times, you know, like we made it very clear. Anyway, the first run out comes ace high, ace four, obviously the big blind is aces, you know, so, I mean, obviously, like, obviously I lost. I mean, obviously he had aces because he three bet and shoved. And the second run out is like brick, brick. And Belitos had some rat that missed. And so we should be chopping the side pot and chopping the main pot. So my share of this roughly should be, my share of the main pot should be 18K basically. It was like 36K in the main pot. Anyway. And then the Spanish guy says, oh, no, 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 I get the whole thing because he basically, I mean, he's saying in Spanish, but people are translating. There's a house rule in Casino Barcelona that you can't run it twice in three-way all-ins. And that the run it twice is only valid for the side pot. And the dealer is trying to tell him, no, you guys agreed to run it for the whole pot. All hell breaks loose. A floor comes over. The first floor rules in my favor, says that we've made an agreement that it's this way. Then he gets another floor to come over. The floor rules in the other guy's favor. And, you know, there's like, it was like chaos for like 30 minutes. It was a huge crowd of people who was screaming going on. Yuha Helpy was like losing his fucking mind on my behalf. Like he was screaming at the floor, telling them that they're like cheating me and it's bullshit. And he asked the floor guy who was ruling against this, he asked for his name, you know, just to know what staff member is making this decision. And the guy wouldn't give it to him. He wouldn't even give him his name. He just kept saying, poker manager, poker manager. And the whole thing was like kind of sketchy because a lot of people were saying like, no, this is a house rule. Like they didn't just make up that rule, which I believe, you know, I had heard something about this rule previously, like people had talked about it. But I only heard about it as you can't run it twice in multi-way pots, period. Not you can't, you can only run it twice for the side pot, you know? And also there were a bunch of other house rules that, cause earlier in the day I was playing 50-100, which is in like the low stakes section, not like low, you know, it's like, there's like the low stakes room, which is like, you know, out in the casino floor. And it's like crowded and messy. And then there's like a high stakes room where there's like 25, it's like 20, 40, 50, 100. And then within the high stakes room, there's a special roped off area of the high stakes room that's for even higher stakes, which is where we were playing, right? And it seemed like once we got there, like the rules kind of changed and people were, like because there were all these silly rules. Like one rule where you can't run it twice for pots smaller than 100 big blinds. That was also a house rule that they just completely ignored when we got to the high stakes section. They were just like, okay, you can run it twice because you guys are playing 100, 200. You can do whatever you want. And that's like a common thing in poker rooms everywhere where the floor, the dealers, they kind of just like let the players run the show, you know? And that's, I mean, that happens in Vegas too, where basically like the dealers just let the players do whatever they want because, you know, it's high stakes and they're paying a lot of rake and they know what's going on. You know, and if casino doesn't let players do that, that's fine, but they have to be consistent, you know? So yeah, that happened. And I didn't get any of the money. So I got cheated out of 18K basically, or hustled or angle shot, whatever word you want to use. Maybe cheated isn't the right word. And I posted on Tuples too because I want people to know about it. And you know, for the most part, most people seem to be sympathetic with what happened and thought it was unfortunate. Obviously, it's Tuples too, so there were a few trolls.
There was.
Like, this is bullshit, you made this all up, or, you know, also, everything we think of some moronic thing that somebody can say they said, obviously. And then there were also some like good legitimate criticisms of me, like, you know, you've been around a while, you should know that running it twice is a gentleman's agreement, and if you don't know the guy, you shouldn't risk it, which is true. I mean, that's a fair criticism. So, you know, I learned my lesson, and I'll be much more careful about running it twice and or doing anything in a foreign casino, you know, where I'm not confident in the staff to protect me as a player.
Mm-hmm. The Barcelona shuffle, guys.
Yeah.
So I guess the one thing to take away, everyone can take away, and the one thing that I took away from this story right away was that if you're playing in any casino, make sure you understand what the actual house rules are pertaining to running twice in any situation, because I think that's an easy way. I mean, not an easy way, but that's a way you can sort of protect yourself in the future if you're ever in a situation like that again.
Yeah, there's a lot of, I mean, actually, running it twice, even in the U.S., is not, my understanding in almost every casino in the U.S., running it twice is not actually enforceable. It's possible in Vegas, I'm not sure, but I don't think so. But I know there's a famous story in L.A. of a sort of well-known live PLO player who got the commerce shuffle, as you would say, where he ran it twice with a guy playing like 50, 100, 100, 200 something in like a 100K pot. And the guy won, his opponent won like the first run. I think they may have run it like 3 or 4 times actually. And then he won like runs like 2, 3, and 4, or 2 and 3 or something. And the guy like was basically like, no, I won the pot. And they're like, no, we agreed to run it this many times. And he's like, no, I don't accept that. And it was like a huge fucking shit show. And they like literally had to like take them into like the back office to like discuss it. And it was like a crowd gathered. People were like heckling the guy apparently. And basically the commerce told them that like, listen, we like legally we can't enforce the later run. We can only enforce the first run. It's like a gaming rule or something. And running it twice is an agreement between players that is settled between players, and we can't interfere. All we can do is, if this guy does this, we can ban him for life. That's all we can do. We can't. There's nothing criminal, nothing legal, or anything we can do. So that actually happened in commerce, which, you know.
Wow.
So, yeah, I mean, you always have to be careful, obviously. I mean, it's gambling.
Yeah, I can hear a little bit echo through your speakers. When I talk. Yeah. Can you turn down a little bit?
Turn, how do I?
The speaker's down a little.
Oh, you're okay. Yeah.
Testing. 587-421-728. Okay, it's good.
Is it good?
It's okay. Yeah. I think I can still hear it a little bit slightly. Sometimes it just happens. There's a little bit of lag, or normally that's what happens and there's a little bit of lag. But it seems good. All right, we're live, guys. Sometimes things happen. So I guess, wow. So what can you do in that situation? So if it's not enforceable, and so you're basically always taking this gentleman's agreement, because I mean, I ran it twice all summer and nothing ever happened, but it sounds like something could happen. So it's like, what do you think people should do in that situation? Like, are you planning to do something different in the future when you're playing in these high stakes live games?
No, I mean, in Vegas, I've never, you know, I played pretty much all summer in Bellagio and a little bit in the Aria. And, like, the vast majority of regulars in the game are playing, like, almost every day and are, you know, trustworthy and they run it twice all the time. Like, there's a couple regs who only run it once. But the vast majority of everyone in those games is running it twice, like every single time. And even if it's like a huge pot, they might agree to run it four times. Mm. And I've never seen anything and I've played a lot of hours in the last couple of years at Bellagio playing like 50, 100, 100, 200. And it's pretty much always been on the up and up. Even like, not only have I never seen anyone do anything shady, I've seen like the exact opposite. Like I've seen people acting like above and beyond honorably in those games, in like situations where there's a discrepancy over a pot size or where a chip came from, or like I've seen guys who always agree to run it twice, like forget to say something before the dealer puts out the first run, and the dealer's like, oh, you guys didn't say anything. And they're like, and then like the winner of the first run is like, no, put out a second run. Like, I would have agreed to it, you know? Like, I've seen that like multiple times. I've been a part of that. So I don't want to make it seem like it's all fucking like chaos in live poker and there's no one to be trusted, because that's really not the case. And I think I'm like kind of glad we're talking about this a little bit, because I think every time this happens, there's always some comment like, you can't trust anyone in the poker world. Like, everyone's a fucking scumbag. And it's, I hate it when people say that, because like my experience in the poker world, you know, like the people I've been close, like I have a huge group of friends that I'm very close with, like a lot of them that are all like very good and like honorable people. And a lot of my like acquaintances who I'm not like friends with, but I'm, you know, are my frequent opponents that I see all the time, that I get along fine with. We're not friends, but we're not enemies. We're just, you know, frequent opponent, colleagues, whatever you want to call us. The vast majority of them are like honorable gamblers and keeps their word. And I think a lot of people who make bad decisions about who to hang out with in the poker world, instead of saying, maybe I have bad judgment about characters, or bad character judgment, No, they don't take personal responsibility for it. They just say like, oh, it's poker world, everyone's a scumbag. And I don't like that, and I don't think it's true. And I think something which has been pointed out to me by other people that sometimes people don't realize or doesn't occur to them in the poker world is they make this point that like, oh, poker players are so shady. Like, look at how many incidents there are. But how many other industries are there where people are constantly, constantly, constantly presented with opportunities to scam and cheat people with like super ease, you know? Like it's in poker, you're dealing with cash all the time and money, that it's just a constant like flow of money. And there's just all this opportunity for people to do something dishonest. And the vast majority of the time people don't do it. But you know, when you work a normal job, you're not just like constantly presented with these opportunities. And I think people just forget that. And, you know, like, I mean, you always see guys like Stinger always posting on like Twitter about like how the poker world is so scummy, which I don't even want to get into the obvious insanity of that. But it's just like, I hate it, because it's just like, you know, no one told you you have to give this person money, right? Like, it's just that person. It's not the poker world's fault, okay? Like, there's plenty of great people in the poker world.
You gave me a couple options to go here. Go from this comment right here.
Yeah, well, you know, you're the choose your own adventure.
I know, this is like a choose. This is definitely choose my own adventure. No, I definitely agree with you. I think that when I hear people say that too, I sort of feel the same way. I mean, I think there's a lot of great people in poker. I've met a ton of great people in poker who are a lot of fun. They're not like, you know, it's not as like as people make it out to be, where it's this like malicious sort of environment where everyone's out to get everyone and people are, you know, putting Trojans on your computer or fucking robbing you in a live game and stuff like that. Like, there, it's not. And maybe, you know, maybe once you get to the, I guess, the higher stakes, usually the people that are around high stakes now tend to be a little bit more, I don't know quite the word I'm looking for, but they tend to be a little bit more something, higher quality or something like that. And those guys are usually pretty good people to know. They're good friends. They're very nice, very helpful. And does that mean they're not doing anything malicious ever? I guess you never know. But if they do, they hide it pretty well. So,
yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, it's, my point is not so much that I think the poker world is cleaner than any other industry or something, because it might not be, but I don't think it's like, and obviously there's tons of shady shit that happens in poker. I'm not saying you should be like, people should need to be more trusting of poker. You need to be distrustful and hold people to a very high standard.
Okay, where does the trust part comes in? So let's say, for instance, I feel like the only times the times you need to trust someone off the top of my head I can think about are if you're loaning someone money, which most likely you normally shouldn't do unless it's a very specific instance. If you're staking someone buying action, you want to trust that person's going to then pay out to you or they're going to be honest, they're not going to dump, or they're not going to, if it's a live cash stake, they're not going to lie about how much money they might have won or lost. But where else are you really trusting people? So you're trusting that people aren't cheating in a live game. You're trusting that people aren't colluding in an online an online sense. Like, is that what you mean by trusting poker players?
Well, I mean, in the way you're phrasing the question, it's almost everything you do in the poker world. Really, it's like any interaction you have with somebody, be it playing with them, an exchange of action in some direction, buying, selling, whatever. You know, swapping money, or I mean, practically everything. I mean, this is kind of my point: is that there's like at every single like opportunity, there's like a chance for something to go wrong. You know, and that's how it is in the poker world. And that's why you have to be very vigilant. But it doesn't. It's not. You know, every time some poker player does something wrong, that's not like an indictment on the entire poker community. You know, that's just that guy who did that. And it's your job as a poker player to judge people's character and protect yourself in some way, you know? And you know, there's obviously like different levels of expectation you can have of how likely a game is to be honest or crooked, you know? If you hear about some private game that, you know, is all whales or whatever, but they invite you for some reason, and you don't you know, you haven't heard from too many trustworthy people that it's an honest game, you should be very, I'm not saying you shouldn't play, but you should, you know, should be very on the lookout for shady things to happen. You know, there's just like that is a situation where you should be careful. You know, if you're playing really high stakes games online, you know, for the most part, you know everyone in the games. So it's a little bit, I'm not saying there's not any cheating. I'm sure there is some, and I'm sure I've been a victim to some that I'm not aware of. I've played millions of hands. I'm sure that's happened. And obviously there's been many cheating scandals in online as well as live poker. But yeah, I mean, you just got to kind of see what's in front of you and just use your best judgment. I mean, you can't just go into every poker game with the same like expectation, like that it's all going to be on the up and up. Mm-hmm. You just have to be smart about it, I guess.
This comment on YouTube was funny. It says, I remember back in 2008 on Full Tilt, a real bird asked me to loan him $1. Send it back in a week. I sent him $1 and he sent me $5 back the next week. Poker's not scummy.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations. I know you're lying, but that'd be cool if it's actually true.
Yeah, I remember those days, the Full Tilt, please send me $5 guys.
Yeah, those, don't get that anymore. Yeah, unfortunately with Poker Stars having, you can't really have rail bird chat. That was always a great thing about, I used to hate the rail chat. So you actually were playing in those games. Did you ever read the chat when you were playing like 500 1K or playing 200, 400 on Full Tilt?
I would always have it off, and then if I like won a big pot or lost a big pot, or it was just a big pot or something, sometimes I would just like turn it on and be like, let's get a little taste. And it'd always be like, OMG, like $75, you just won a 50K pot, you know, like just going, like it would be like going crazy. And I'd be like, all right, that's enough, turn it off.
Well, let's what I want to talk about first. I mean, there's a bunch of cool things I want to talk about, but I guess let's talk about the recent high stakes PLO action. Obviously, Isler came back. I haven't really seen you too much in the 200, 400 games or playing any of the heads up matches where Isler was playing. What's been happening with that? So, I haven't seen you much in the. Have you even played any 1-2 or 2-4 in the past couple weeks since it's been running? Maybe the last month, I feel like it's been running.
Yeah, I've been playing a little. I played a few, like last few days, I've been playing a decent amount of 1-2. Mm-hmm. I haven't been on the biggest upswing lately, so I'm not trying to battle in like the really tough, really high stakes games. Like if I could play in the same game, like those 200, 400 games that are running, if I could play that at like lower stakes, I would. But it's a really big game. Like they've been playing ante too, you know, and like 200, 400 ante with Ivy and Isildur, both who are just kind of maniacs. At least pre-flop, and they make the pots really big. It's just a huge game, and I'm not like, I don't think I need to be like
going crazy to playing those games. I've been mostly just playing when certain someone is in the games. Who shall remain nameless.
Is it a young man who might have been spotted playing live poker this summer as well too?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, makes sense. Do you feel like 2000 and what year Anski? Let's say we go back and talk to Anski from a certain year. What year Anski would not play in these games also? I feel like most past years Anski would be playing in these 200, 400 games. Like you'd be like, well, I mean, hey, you know, I'm going to play in the games. It's the highest games running. But now it seems like you're a little bit more content with the idea of not playing those games.
In past years, I wasn't good enough at PLO to play in these games, so I probably wouldn't have. Mm-hmm. Although the difference also was that like 5 years ago, Isildur was like a raging fish at 6-max PLO. He was like the worst ever, and he's pretty good now. So maybe I would have played a few years ago because Isildur used to be terrible at 6-max PLO. Mm-hmm. But he's kind of a completely different player now, so it's not really the same question, I guess. He used to just be like opening like 50% from like under the gun, you know. He was like a complete insane lunatic. Now he's like kind of solid, I guess.
Is he though? Because I watch the matches. I look at some of the hands. Doesn't seem like he's that solid. I mean, but from what we've come to think of as solid at PLO 6-max. So I feel like we come to think about fundamentals and being solid from this standpoint. He sort of comes from this standpoint where it's like what he's doing to him might seem solid to us. We're like, the fuck is he doing? But like, I'm not sure if he's obviously on a huge upswing. Obviously, it's a lot of variance. The sample size is getting bigger, but it's still relatively short sample size, and he's crushing. So I'm not sure how much better he really got at these 6-max games. I know a lot of it is from heads up as well too, but a lot of it, I feel like he's been winning a decent amount in the 6-max games too.
Yeah, I mean, he solid's maybe not the best word. He's certainly not like solid as you would describe most people. Solid compared to like 2010 Isildur, I guess. Yeah, his like fundamentals aren't like the best or whatever. But actually, like in PLO, that's like kind of a weird question because there's a lot of like very good players. There's a lot of like different groups of very good players who approach like pre-flop PLO very differently. Mm-hmm. And you know, I for the most part side with like more of like one group, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the other group is like to be totally dismissed or anything like that. And Isildur. One thing about Isildur is that unlike some players who are, you know, who games run, I mean, he adjusts and changes his game a lot. Like he's not like playing the same all the time, you know, like he's really changing like very rapidly based on, what he sees other people doing that beats him. And he either changes his game to adjust to it, or he sees other people doing something that he likes and then he copies it. Mm-hmm. I watched a little bit of your podcast with Ben86, and he's talking and he, you know, spoke very highly of Isildur as like a poker mind and like what he's able to do. He basically said like Isildur is like the total, like the ultimate intuition player. He doesn't, he doesn't like go into the lab and do like all the work, but he figures shit out somehow. And especially figures it out in some games where it's really hard to figure out, like not just, you know, hold them, like much more technical games, I guess. He's saying that maybe he has more intel than I do. I don't know what Isildur does. So I think it's like, maybe I don't want to assume that he doesn't do any technical work, but maybe he does. And it's, you know, and it's all part of the hustle to make us think he's just like fishing it up, but I think he probably doesn't.
I don't think so. From what I've heard, I don't think there's much technical work happening behind the scenes.
But what I'm saying is, like, people
people don't give enough credit to Slaughter. Like, people, like, games run around him, and, like, people are, like, bum hunting him that are probably not as good as him. And it's kind of silly. There's like a, I see you trying to figure it out. I'm not going to say anything.
I know. I'm like, wait, I'm trying to think. Oh, let me brainstorm the players here.
Like, part of it, and it's totally understandable, is that there's, like, this mystique to Isildur. It's just, like, people just want to play with it. People want to just, like, be around the games when he's playing, you know? And it's pretty deserved, I guess. I mean, he's remarkable. Like, did you see that graph that Frank posted on your Facebook page? It's, like, the lifetime Isildur graph.
Oh, yeah, it's a sick graph, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like the real graph. It's not like by hand, so it's not like, it doesn't look like a normal poker tracker graph, but it's kind of like a by year thing. And it's just completely insane, obviously, but he's like a totally unique, like, one of a kind creature in the poker world. You know, you look at, like, all the successful, like, really successful people at high stakes, and they all have, like, a pretty similar approach. Not, like, I don't mean similar necessarily, like, they all think about the game the same way, but they all, you know, are analytical, studying, like, mostly mathematical, very, like, game theory oriented approach. Some are maybe not as game theory oriented, they're more exploitative oriented, but it's still based in work. Like, they don't take the game theory approach, but they still, like, they analyze their opponents, the databases that they have on their opponents, and they do exploitative work that way. Something, you know, those are still, like, relatively similar ways of approaching a game. And then you have Isildur, who's just like, fuck that, I'm just gonna play 75,000 hands against the best in the world, and then after that I'll be pretty close to being the best.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, and he just kind of just figures it out, and it's remarkable. I mean I've been trying to learn mixed games, you know, and it's, like, really, really hard, and I just have no idea what I'm doing most of these games, and he just kind of, like, hopped in and pretty quickly became, like, one of the best 8-game players in the world, I think. I mean, I don't know, because I don't play the high stakes mixed games, so I'm not speaking with too much authority here, but my understanding is that, you know, yeah, sure, games run around him sometimes at, like, deuce, but that doesn't mean he's not, like, one of the best, you know? Just because, like, the 5 best in the world play him, that doesn't mean he's not, like, the 7th best or something, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. He seems like he's probably quite good at 08. That game, I really have no idea. So I shouldn't even. I'm not going to comment about 08.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing to watch. Obviously, the heads up matches he has. He's been playing everyone, playing Hollywood, playing Ben, playing Sauce with Color. Took a shot, and now he sort of fell back, and I don't know if he's playing much anymore against Isildur. Who else has really been playing a lot? I feel like he's been playing pretty much everyone. Everyone heads up, and is he still getting action? Is he still getting the same heads up action, or is it just from, like, Hollywood and Ben now at this point?
Yeah, I guess it's mostly the Bens and Ike that play him. I think he probably has gotten some action from Vroom, I think.
Oh yeah, Vroom's crushing. You see Vroom's latest graph?
Yeah, I saw. He's crushing.
Yeah, he's crushing. Yeah.
Yeah. Not very surprising. He's really good. So yeah, I guess he's mostly getting action from, like, just the bosses. And is holding his own. Like, people need to understand, like, when Ike or Ben, like, you know, seem like they're waiting for Isildur at, like, 200, 400. Like, yeah, they want to play him, but they're not, like, you know, they're not, like, stop everything in the world. This is the biggest fish I've ever seen. Like, he's, you know, he's good. Like, he's, like, these guys are just, like, the best, though, and they think they're better than him, you know? It's not, like, I think some railbirds kind of think that Isildur is, like, is still, like, just, like, a huge fish or something. And he's not, like.
Mm-hmm. Hollywood's, he's not that happy to fire the Dream Machine up, but he's still going to fire the Dream Machine up and take on Isildur, huh?
Well, apparently, it seems like Isildur has cracked the Dream Machine. There's a
The code is broken.
I know what's happening here. Yeah. I got to tell you, I love seeing, I like Hollywood. I like them a lot, but I love seeing those other crack the Dream Machine. Like, I just want to know the Dream Machine can be beaten. It makes me feel good. And yes. maybe, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if he's going broke this time. Normally he goes on these runs and then eventually gives it back. I'm like, what happens at some point? Can he just win all the money? Like if he goes on up 10 million, 6 million more, he's up 10 million. Like that's a lot of money to be taken out of the poker economy.
Well, put it this way. He's either going to win all the money or he's going to lose all the money. Cause he doesn't, it's not like he's never going to like stop. He's never going to like, you know what? Poker's been good. I've had a good run. I'm going to open up a clothing store or something, a hair salon. It's gonna stay in action, you know.
A clothing store or a hair salon?
I don't know. I was thinking about his Swedish hair, you know, like the.
That's true.
Hey, I don't know. What do Swedish people open up? Whatever.
Well, Barry Sweet allegedly says that he owns, no surprise here, some sort of berry company. I don't know if he's trolling me when he said this, but I mean, there could be some legitimacy behind it. He made the nickname Barry Sweet with the Barry avatar. He certainly might own some sort of Barry corporation. So maybe, and Johan lives with his mom and lives with his parents. So, you know, he's not investing much of that money. He's been winning. Fucek probably lives with his parents too. Izzeldrun, obviously, he invests in the odd odds and lifestyle of traveling the world and punting away as much money as possible.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to find like a unifying like theory of how the Swedes spend their money.
That's true. I guess there's a little bit of nit, a little bit of craziness in the mixture here. All right, I'm going to give you a question. I was playing basketball for a couple hours before today. I drank like four of these waters potentially. So I gotta go to the bathroom. And I don't want to use the, you know, I'm a podcast here. I don't use the bottle here. So. What's a good question where I can just run to the bathroom real quick and use this here? Okay, so why don't we talk about your recent play? So you've been mainly playing during WCOOP. So did you put in a lot of hours during WCOOP with all the action that's running? Obviously, last podcast we talked about, you know, seizing the opportunity, and you were very passionate. You got me pumped up. You're like, when the games are running, you got to take advantage of it. You got to get in the games. You got to play. But also, it sounds like you're in a little bit of a downswing. So did that sort of hinder your motivation to play as much as those games are running? Obviously now, you know, the 10, 20, 20, 50, not running as often. The higher stakes is running because Budimus is playing. But yeah, let's talk about that.
Yeah, I played a lot during WCOOP. I usually, during the coops, during Scoop and WCOOPs, I always play a ton because games are always running, like I said. This one went pretty poorly, so I definitely, by the end of it, after putting in tons of hours and not winning any money and losing a lot, it took a lot out of me, I guess. You know, I probably wasn't playing my best. I was definitely not running my best in terms of, like, all in EV. And I guess part of it is, when we last spoke, you know, I was on a pretty big heater probably. That was when I think it was. And it's obviously always easier to be motivated when you're winning. And then when you're losing, it's harder to be motivated. So, you know, I always like when I'm in like the poker grind mode and I'm like super focused and playing every day and like just waking up and thinking about poker, it's easy for me to think that that's never going to end, you know, but I'm a human and we all burn out sometimes. And after this WCOOP, I took like a while off, like a while. I mean, it was like a week, whatever, but that's like a while for me.
I took a while off. I was out of commission for a week. Okay, I guess a while. Okay.
I was like a week of like not even like opening poker stars is what I mean.
Wow. Okay.
And then like I've been slowly trickling back and, in October, I've actually been up a lot, and I've barely been playing. So maybe I cracked the code and just need to play like 300 hands a day, and I'll just keep winning. I mean, like regarding what I said in like the last podcast, and I know like a lot of people like tweeted at me that they said it was like very motivational what I said. I still believe all of that for sure. And I'm very much like still in that mindset that like this is like an opportunity for me to do really well in the next like couple of years. And I'm very, very motivated behind that. But there's, you know, hiccups along the way, and sometimes I have to remind myself that like, I can't, you know, I can't all do it at once. Like, you know, and like with poker, like if you have like a really good game that you have an opportunity to play and it's like really high stakes, and you can get to a situation where, or you can get into like a habit where you think about your hourly in the game and you can't justify doing anything else with your life. You're like, well, I'm making $500 an hour right now. Like, it would be irresponsible to like go get a beer with my friends, you know? And I still mostly believe that, but the issue is that like, there's a cap on it. You can't literally do that all the time. Like you would never ever be able to do anything. So I think part of like the balance that you need to achieve is sometimes like when I'm doing like an activity during the day with Stephanie, fiance, like the key is like, if I'm going to wake up and go do something, I just don't even open PokerStars, because like, if we're going, you know, we're going, taking the dogs for like a hike, you know, it's like something we did the other day. If I wake up and you know who is playing 100, 200 or something, and which means he's going to be around all day, like, of course I can't go take the dogs for a hike. I might win like 150K today. Like, you know, so the mentality has to just kind of be like, today is just not poker. Like, today I'm just going to do this, and I can't, like, you know, that's kind of just like the way I have to separate it. Otherwise, you know, I would never leave my, never leave my chair, which is mostly what I do anyway. But just a little bit of like, of just separation of that, and just not, you know, being able to just turn down what should be a plus EV situation, just for mental sanity and to sort of stay stable, I guess, is you know, I'm saying this, and like, and I said what I said in the last podcast about motivation. Like, all these things, you know, I don't necessarily always practice what I preach, right? A lot of time it's like, this is what I believe should be, but I make mistakes and I have my flaws, and I sometimes don't always do what I think is best. You know, there's times when I'm like, I really should take a break right now. Like, I'm getting buried. These games are not that good. They're like pretty good, but they're not like glue yourself to your chair good. And I still play through in those situations when I just kind of know I should just take a break, and I'm probably not playing my best because I'm losing. So, you know, it's, I have my moments like that where I know I need to settle down a little bit, but you know, it's hard sometimes.
You sound like you're in different mood than last time we had you on the podcast here.
Well, it's kind of like I said, I just like, I played so much in September and just got buried that it kind of like, it's, I don't know, it's kind of like slapped me around a little and made me just like want to just chill a little bit from poker. But it's like, I guarantee in like a month I'm going to be like right back to like full grind mode or whatever, you know? But yeah, I mean, in the last like year I've run like exceedingly terrible. I would be very surprised if like, anyone playing 2550 has run worse than me. And it's pretty like draining, and there's times when I wake up and I'm like perfectly fine, and I just like play through, and I'm just like, I can take like a huge loss and I'll be fine. But you know, sometimes it just like adds up, and then at some point I kind of just like, not snap, but like I just like, I lose like my hunger a little bit, and I just kind of get like,
I don't know what the word is, but I kind of just like lose my edge or whatever, and I just want to just chill and just like veg out and not think about poker for a while because it's been like such a disappointment for so long, you know? So that happens sometimes.
What do you think about playing lower stakes for a period of time?
I mean, I do.
Just lower stakes at all. No anything, no higher, just lower stakes for a period of time.
That might be a good idea. It's not something that I do easily. Like there's times when, like that's another problem I have. Like there's times when there's like a medium 25-50 pool running, like not that good, but like okay, like one or two maybe not great players and then like all the bosses playing. And then there's like a 10-20 pool with like, it's like a bunch of scrubby regulars and a bunch of green tags.
Yeah.
Green is my fun fact tag. And I look and I'm like, I know that the 10-20 pools is not just like a better idea for my, you know, for during a downswing. It's like literally like a higher hourly probably. And I still like always choose, not always, but I still find myself choosing 25-50 too often just because I guess I've just played so much of it that it feels like I'm, I don't know, like just like moving down feels, I don't know what the word is. It just feels like I'm not like surrendering or whatever, but I'm like, I'm going the wrong direction, you know, like, but it's just, I think it's just like a dumb, like it's really annoying that there's like certain things that I know like I should be better at in life. And it's like a conscious decision that I make to make the wrong decision. And I like watch myself doing it, but it happens like all the time. And I think that's like something a lot of people deal with in a lot of different things in life. You know, it's sometimes a lot of people can always see like what the right answer is and don't always go for it because of some tendencies that they have.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, in the case of like playing like 10-20 or something or 5-10, I mean, there's a lot of times where it would be just much strictly better for my time, and I just choose not to. So that's definitely something I need to work on.
I think that's one of the biggest things of a poker player is an ability to sort of, you know, go back down and you know, regain confidence, regain momentum. And I think the thing is, there are some people who are just really good at the game and they can sort of overcome that leak. And there are some people who probably that sends them busto, like that inability to move back down, just really, they can never recover from it. And there's probably been countless number of people that are like that.
Yeah, yes. Actually, last night I was playing and
I saw you 6 a.m. this morning, kid, and I saw you battling at the 10-20 deep tables, man.
Yeah, I was playing 10-20 and there was 100, 200 running with open seats and I decided not to play. So I actually chose to play 10-20.
I mean, you say that jokingly. That's a small, that's a thing. I mean, like that's something to be.
You take like something from. Computer game too. It wasn't like, I mean, it was like obviously tougher than the 10-20 game, but it wasn't like an insane tough game or something.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I guess, relatively speaking, it was insanely tough, but you know, for 100, 200, it wasn't that bad.
Do you feel as if competition's getting a lot stronger, a little bit quicker? Do you feel like you're still playing at that same high level? Like, do you think it's anything to do with that? Or do you think it's just maybe a little bit of confidence and a little bit of run bad sort of combined and sort of just bringing your game down maybe from that A-plus notch to maybe like an A status?
It's both. I mean, games are definitely getting tougher. A lot of regulars who I used to think were just okay or not that good, I now think are like really good. There's a few of those guys. And there's certainly not many that I used to think were good that I now think are bad. Like most aren't getting worse. Well, I guess a couple that are getting worse. It's not surprising. Obviously there's other, I mean, poker's, especially high stakes poker, it's really, really cutthroat and everybody is trying to get better and everybody's working really hard. And
you know, you start slacking and it'll show. I don't think I've been slacking or anything like that. I do think I could probably start putting in more time off the table, doing more work than I've been doing. Because basically, whenever I'm like putting in a ton of volume, I'm usually neglecting studying because I'm always like, you know, well, I could study how to play 2550 or I could play 2550.
Right, yeah, yeah.
We can play. And then it's more when there's like a lot of downtime, I end up doing a little more studying, and a little more work. So I know I should do more studying. It's something that another thing I need to probably work on. Sorry, what was it was like a 2-part question. You said there are the regular, am I just playing worse? I definitely play worse when I'm on a downswing. I don't think anyone plays better on a downswing. And it affects me in weird ways. I mean, sometimes it manifests as like being a little bit more, just being like less focused during a session because I'm like kind of just pissed. I think one thing that I've noticed that I do is when I'm on a heater and I'm in the middle of a session, I really don't care what my results are. I'm kind of like just focused on playing. When I'm in a big downswing, I like lose 2 buy-ins and I'm immediately like checking poker tracker, like how much am I down? How much am I down?
Oh yeah.
No, and that's just like such a bad habit, but it's hard to break and something I know I need to work on.
Maybe hopefully get some podcast run good. I've been stealing all the recent podcast run good for myself. So I think Ben 86 didn't quite get much during the last podcast because he lost like 800K immediately after being on the podcast. So
it's a long term run good though. You can't just look at the first session after.
Yeah, it's true. I'm sure Ben 86 is going to come out on top of the. I guess so. Going forward here, you're in Toronto right now still?
Vancouver.
Oh, Vancouver. Oh yeah, you told me you went to Vancouver. Okay. How do you like being in Vancouver? What's life like there? Do you feel like your personal life might be able to sort of bring spirits up or maybe get a little escape from that? Obviously, you're there with the fiance, but in terms of friends or anything like that or activities?
Yeah, I really love it here. I'm really happy in Vancouver. I think the city's great and I'm very happy we moved here. It's quite different than living in Mexico, obviously, where we lived before. Yeah, I mean, we've been doing like a lot of like nature-y things, like going on hikes and you know, things of that sort. And yeah, that stuff, it always helps me like mentally when I do that. And like I said, I haven't been playing much poker lately.
Mm-hmm.
But that's also because like we're getting married in 3 weeks, so I've been kind of busy with that. Although. When Stephanie watches this, she'll laugh when I say I've been busy with that because she obviously does most of the work, or all the work, really. and so she probably doesn't like that I said that. okay, I haven't been busy at all with the wedding. But mentally, it makes me busy, you know? It's like I have to think about it. Yeah, like I was originally, my original plans were I was going to go to Europe for Malta EPT right before the wedding and then maybe do like the World Series also. But I decided to like screw that. I'm just going to stay here and relax and work out and just focus on playing a little bit online and just take it easy, I guess.
What's friend status like there? You got any people you're hanging out with?
Yeah, just some other poker players, some other poker couples. I mean, there's a lot of poker players here, obviously. Mm-hmm. I had dinner with the Galfons the other day.
Oh, the Galfons.
Yes.
The newly married couple themselves. Oh, hey, now you're in couples. You're in couple. You got to like find Benny Six and his girlfriend, or you got Phil and his wife, and who else is up there that's coupled up now?
I don't know. Like other, I think, I don't really, they're not like my friends really, or we're like acquaintances, but I think like JMO and Doug live up here.
some of their crew.
They're kind of a couple. Okay, J-Mo and Doug, they're definitely a couple. I mean,
Doug and his girlfriend or whatever, you know. But, yeah, sure, Mrs. Doug and Doug, yeah. Yeah, we don't really hang out, but I'm pretty sure they live here somewhere.
Yeah, they live. I think they live close to you, actually. You tell me what area are you living in?
Like West End.
Yeah, okay, they live really close to you, yeah.
All right.
How do you like West End?
It's nice. It's a nice neighborhood. It's really quiet and green. You know, it's kind of my, what I am interested in for a neighborhood. I'm not really trying to go out and party. We kind of live in like the gay neighborhood.
I know you live in the gay neighborhood. So I was asking you how you like the West End.
but no, we like the West End is like kind of big, but we live in like specifically like the gay neighborhood of the West End. So yeah,
Didn't spend much time. I was more like Yale Town, Gas Town. I didn't really spend too much time in the West End when I was living there. So, although there was a place called Celebrities there, that was a gay club that had a straight crazy EDM night on Tuesday that we'd go to all the time, and that was sort of a little bit intense. And
yeah, that's pretty close to my place.
Oh, okay, yeah, you're I mean, you're in a good spot. You're right by downtown. You're not too far from the main little area over there. So how's the food over there? How's the restaurants in that part of town?
Good. Vancouver food seems pretty good. It's not as good as like any of the other cities I've lived in. I mean, it's better than Playa del Carmen, but it's not as good as like Toronto or New York or Las Vegas.
Where are you eating at?
Been to Veges quite a few times, which is probably the best restaurant I've been to in the city. It's really good. I mean, I don't know.
This might be the problem, right? You're not trying any of the good places, man.
I'm trying. Don't worry. I am very.
Yeah, you're a professional eater, so like if anyone's trying the food there, you're trying the food. I'm gonna parlay us into the next. Go ahead, keep going.
The sushi situation in Vancouver.
This is what I was gonna go. Okay, go ahead. Now we're getting started. Let's go.
The sushi situation in Vancouver is pretty bad, and I just don't understand why. It's on the West Coast. Close to Japan. I mean, not close, but, you know,
I love it.
We're closer than most of the rest of North America. The sushi in Vancouver fucking sucks. It's a joke. I don't understand what's up with it.
We figured out we figured things out, guys. We just figured out why Anski might be a little down right now is because the sushi situation is not up to GTO standards. Go ahead. Tell us more about the sushi situation there.
Yeah, I really don't know what it is exactly, but first of all, very few places import Japanese fish. Most of them have like local fish, Canadian fish. I don't know if it's like because they're so big into like the sustainable local food thing here. Not that I'm not, but sometimes you just want to eat some, you know, some bluefin toro. There's that. I don't know. I mean, there's very few like authentic style, like Japanese, like just omakase places. They're most of like the high end sushi places here are like, you know, kind of like Nobu style. Not that Nobu's not good. I like Nobu, but you know what I mean? More of like the, like, clubby, like fashionable looking, yeah,
fancier sort of places. Fancier sushi. Like,
the focus is not like this is a place for sushi, like this is what you eat here. You know, for I guess there's probably a lot of Vegas people who watch this. If anyone's been to like Kabuto in Vegas, like the best sushi place in Vegas, there's nothing like that here. There's nothing even remotely close to that here. Yeah, it's kind of a disappointment. I don't really get it. And there's tons of Japanese people here too. I don't understand. They can get like incredible sushi in the middle of Vegas, in the fucking desert, but they can't get it here.
Is there not one good sushi place up there?
I mean, there's a bunch that are like fine, that are like pretty good, but there's none that are like, there's none that like leave me feeling like my mind is blown. Like that happens at like Kabuto in Vegas, or
you got high standards though.
Or Sushi Zo in LA, or Yasuda or Gari in New York, or anywhere in Japan.
Yeah, your standards are so high right now with the sushi, man. I mean, not much can really deliver.
My standards are high, but like, I'm not exaggerating that like sushi in Vancouver is like very weak compared to other like major North American cities. We still eat sushi like once or twice a week because I love it that much. But like, it's quite a bit worse than like other major North American cities. It's not, this isn't me just being like, well, I've eaten sushi in Japan, so everything is terrible comparatively. Like, I do think the sushi I had in Japan was better than any I've had in like Vegas or LA or New York, but there's still incredibly good sushi in like Vegas, LA, and New York, you know?
Sushi downswing is right, man. You're on a sushi downswing right now. Is there anything you can support? Is there like, is there any sort of hope on the horizon here? Or is it just like, this is what you got?
The best place right now is a place actually really close to me. It's called Sushi Maumi or something, or Maumi. It's like a tiny little place that has just a Japanese guy and his wife, and he makes the sushi, and she's like, you know, front of house sort of like. It's literally only two people in the entire restaurant, no wait staff, no bus staff. And it's like pretty good, and they try hard, and they like import like Japanese fish. But it's still nothing compared to like the good stuff. There's another pretty good place called Sushi Kaide, which is in like Yale Town. It's like pretty good, but again, big disappointment.
Well, I just figured out a bucket list item to add on. The last bucket list item I added on was see Deadmau5 live with Elky, because Elky is obviously obsessed with Deadmau5. Eat sushi with Donnie in a top 1% GTO sushi place. I need to put this on my bucket list because I just have to have this experience. You know, it sounds like Vegas though. Is Kabuto, is that considered, would that be considered a qualifier for the bucket list item here?
Yeah, I think Kabuto is like among the best.
Kabuto. Is it right?
Kabuto is among the best I've had in the United States. And like when we were in Japan, my friends and I, we were pretty regularly using like Kabuto as like a benchmark of like to compare to like the best you can get in North America. It might not be like literally the best, like there might be a couple places better in LA or maybe something better in New York. There's probably really good sushi in San Francisco too, though I haven't experienced that. But we kept like using that as like benchmark in Japan from which to compare everything. And we all agreed that like if we had Kabuto in Japan, we would have been like happy with it. It would have been a good meal. It would not have been like the best or anything we had there, but it would have been a very solid, good meal, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And the price is very reasonable for the quality of the fish. It, like you can get a incredibly good meal for like $70 or something, or $60, I think.
Let's talk about something happier. So you had your bachelorette parties at EDC this year.
Yeah, that was mostly Stephanie's bachelorette party. It wasn't really my bachelor party.
Was that not your bachelor party? It seemed like it was pretty bachelor because I went the same group you were with, and it seemed pretty big. It was like a type experience.
It was kind of just like everybody, because she was having her bachelorette party in Vegas during the summer where everybody was around, and they wanted to do EDC, so they just kind of, she said, you know, we'll have one night with like where the guys all come out to. And so it was like one night where we went out at EDC and had like a huge group.
Yeah, that was the biggest group I've ever seen to a music festival in my life. I was like, there's a lot of people right here.
Yeah, there were like 60 people or something. It was insane.
Yeah, the preparation for that group was very, it was well done. It was a well organized group. They had the meeting spot. There was like people who were the dictators. Like there was the party guys who were setting up the pre-activity, you know. It was a good group. It was a really good mix, man. It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was good. We have a good time. My friends always say that I always pretend like I don't want to go to EDC, but then I have the best time. It's probably true. I've been accused of not enjoying fun things. You know, I prefer a quiet night at home with some whiskey and maybe some sushi. than partying. But EDC is always a good time. The only reason I always kind of, the thing I hate about EDC that is always just, I always dread it, is the ride home.
I was going to say the ride home is the worst, especially when there's, but this year it didn't seem like there was too much traffic on the way. When we got back to the house in like 15 minutes, which
this year was not bad. It's like, if you have a limo, it's much better because the limos wait in a separate parking lot where there's no traffic getting out. Like, cause just getting out of the parking lot takes like an hour normally. But it's not just the ride home. It's like, it's 5 a.m. or 6 a.m. The sun is up. You feel like, you just feel like, so like all you want to do is just be in bed. And you can't. You have to wait like 2 hours. You have to wait for people to come out. And I just dread that last part. But other than that, it's fun.
That's a big part of things. I mean, that's why whenever I think about music festivals, I always factor in the ride home or the trip home, whether you're like wherever you go. And that's why my favorite is in Miami at Ultra, because the hotels are next to the festival. So you walk from the festival to your hotel. You're there in 5 minutes in your bed. If you're by yourself, you're with a person, whatever, you do what you got to do, and you're there. Whereas EDC or even Tomorrowland in Belgium, where you got to trek, if you're not camping, you got to trek an hour and a half home or an hour home. It's fucking terrible. It is.
Yeah, I've never been to those, but Ultra sounds much better in terms of convenience.
Yeah, I mean, you could helicopter home from EDC. They have that option too.
Yeah, how much is it, like 500 a person or something? I think it's expensive, but not like.
Right. I took it 1 year home, and it was, I think, 500 or 1K a person, and they take you to the airport. So you still have to go from like the little airport, the helicopter airport they have. You have to take a Uber or taxi to back to your hotel. So it's not like it doesn't drop you off at Vidara, unfortunately, your house or whatever.
That's bullshit. They should be landing on the roof at Vidara.
I mean, I thought they would do that at Wynn or something. Like why wouldn't they just drop you off like on the roof of Wynn? Like that, it seems like they should have something like that set up, but they don't quite have that worked out yet. So. A couple people in the chat were saying, is this the Sushi Life podcast? What the fuck is it? Listen, then. You can't ask that question. You must not. This is a continued discussion with Anski here, man. We started this discussion long ago. We're continuing the discussion every time he comes on. We love talking sushi. We get so much sushi knowledge from the guy. We would be, it'd be criminal to almost not talk about it. So what have you been doing since EDC that would be considered fun? What have you done that you would say that was fun outside of the nature walks in Vancouver?
I mean, I went to Barcelona. Other than the Barcelona shuffle, it was and not winning any money, it was still a fun trip. It's like one of my favorite cities in Europe. It's just like really beautiful, and the architecture is nice, and people are really friendly, and the food is incredibly good. All the even like the tourist traps in like the neighbor, you know, like the really touristy neighborhoods that are like overpriced, they're still like really good. And then there's obviously some like extremely elite non-touristy places that I went to, and the jamón. Have you ever had Spanish jamón?
What's that?
JAMON. Like the it's like all right. You had prosciutto before?
Yes.
And like the thin.
Yeah, I've had that before. Yeah.
Okay, it's basically like Spanish prosciutto. It's like a different style, and that's like really big there, and it's like the best ham in the world, basically. And it's everywhere, and it's just like it's like the national dish, basically, and it's very delicious, and you can get it everywhere, and you can get like really good quality jamón everywhere, like in. Three years ago when I was in Barcelona, I was with a couple of friends, and we were trying to get a bite to eat at like 3 a.m. There was like nothing open, and we were like kind of drunk, and we stumbled into some bar that had a kitchen that was still open, and we looked at the menu, and it was like, it just looked like disgusting. Like it was like microwavable pizzas and like frozen beef patties and things like that. And we were just kind of like, this looks gross. And then they had a list of like their charcuterie, like the hams that they had. And this place was like a fucking dump, right? But they had a list of like all these hams that they had. And then like in the back, we noticed they had like a room for curing their own hams, where they like make their own hams, and they look like incredibly good. So it was like that was like pretty typical of like Barcelona, where like this bar is like some shithole, like where they don't clean the toilet or whatever, and they have like the worst food ever otherwise. But when it comes to ham, they have like their special like separate room that's like clean and pristine, and they take great pride in like making their ham. So that's kind of like what the ham culture is like over there.
I really like Barcelona. It's I don't know if this is like all European cities, but like 3 a.m. there's just the streets are crowded.
And well, that's especially a Spanish thing. Like Spanish people eat dinner at like 10 p.m. Like you'll go out for dinner at like 7 p.m. and like nothing will even be open yet. Yeah, they eat really late. They go out, party really late, like partying until like 6, 7 a.m. or whatever is like pretty normal there. Because they take naps in the middle of the day. They have siestas.
Whoa, a siesta? What is this?
You don't know about siestas?
I know about a fiesta. Hey, colamosa, caramona, si. I know about a fiesta. I don't know about a siesta. What's a siesta?
Siesta is a midday nap.
I'm in.
Well, it's when you like stores will like restaurants, shops, a lot of them will like close at like noon until like 2 p.m. or 3 p.m. or something. And they'll like, you'll go home, eat a big lunch, and then take a nap and then come back to work. Yeah, this is like a lot of this is not uncommon in I don't think they do it. Maybe they do it in Italy too, I'm not sure. But they definitely there was this was a thing sometimes in Mexico, in Playa del Carmen. This was like something that drove me insane sometimes about living there. And it was like one of the frustrating things. Like so like a lot of stores on their signage it would say like open from 10 a.m. till 1 p.m. and then close from 1 p.m. till 3 p.m. and then open from 3 p.m. until 6 p.m. or something like that, right? And I would like regularly, like it would be like a butcher shop near my house, and I would go at like 3:30 p.m., like half an hour after they're supposed to be open again, and there'd be nobody there, it would be closed, and I would like stand there waiting just like a few minutes, and like after 15 minutes, like the guy would come and look like he had literally just like just woken up, 45 minutes late to work, and it's like, oh hey, yeah, let me like come on, like I'll sell you some beef or whatever. I mean, I didn't know it's not the big a deal, but it was just that type of thing happened all the time. It was like very hard to just like things just didn't function like a normal place because people just would oversleep and not be open at the hours that they
stay. They sleep in, they forget to set the alarm, and they just don't come back to work. It's like, fuck it, I'm not gonna go back to the shop today. And
yeah, I've been told that's more like a Playa del Carmen thing because it's like a beach town, and that life in Mexico City is much more like normal.
I want to see these guys take a siesta on Adderall. I challenge them. I fucking challenge these guys to try to take a siesta on Adderall. You're not going to be able to.
I think only Americans take Adderall. I don't think that's a Spaniard thing to do.
Luckily, I've been not taking that for a couple months now. I feel great. I'm finally starting to get back into like a normal person sort of thinking, and I miss Adderall a little bit. Do you ever take an Adderall before?
A few times. I took it like a couple of times when I was in college and I was like cramming, which it works remarkably well. Mm-hmm. And I took it a few times for poker, but I didn't really like it. I thought it made me too jittery and didn't, I didn't feel like I actually was focusing more. It just felt like I was just like hyper kind of.
That makes sense.
But yeah, I mean, whatever floats your boat.
Somebody in the Twitch chat said something I have to comment on because this was my biggest tilting issue. Someone said in Ibiza, there's the same dive bar, ham hanging over the bar was so sick. And then someone said, Ibiza is GTO for everything except food. I got to say, that was literally the worst food I ever had in my life was in Ibiza. I was so tilted. Like that was my first really experience in Spain. And the food there was so poor. And then I found some place that had a steak and I was in heaven. And
yeah, I've never been to Ibiza. I've only been to Barcelona and Madrid.
You're married, man. You don't go. You don't need to go there. Don't go. You're good.
All right. Thanks. I'm off.
Single though, you gotta go. a good time. Everyone's tan. The sun's hot. You get a nice tan. You're walking around. There's a lot of music. People are dancing. People are offering you things. You're meeting people from different countries. It's a great time. Yeah, it really is. It's a... I'm not going to pronounce it how people pronounce it. I'm not going to say the... I'm not going to say it. Yeah, I don't want to say it like that. I just don't want to. What's... Let's talk about some of the guys that I guess we could have, we're like sort of going over the here and there, but I know Phil Ivey allegedly has been playing a lot of PLO lately online. What are your thoughts on Phil Ivey's game these days? It seems like he's the fun player in these spots. Like he's the reason the games are running, which obviously a bunch of years ago, this would have seemed crazy to imagine a games running around Phil Ivey, but now it seems like he is the person that's driving the action, the reason the games are running.
Yeah, you keep saying apparently. Is it?
No, I said allegedly, not apparently.
Oh, or you did say, oh, yeah, you said allegedly, like, he's, like, it's just confirmed that's him, right? Like, I assumed it was, like, not even, like, a dispute that that's him.
I don't know. I mean, I saw him.
Anyway, so we'll just talk about Ray's ones. Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, a lot of people seem to be kind of, like, surprised that games are running around him. And, like, my response is, like, why are you, like, it just seems, like, crazy that anyone's surprised. Like, what do you think has been happening in the last, like, 4 years in online poker, like people, like this is what happens to poker when online players are playing it. Like Hold'em moves, like moved forward, like Limit Hold'em is like the first example of a game that went from like its infancy to like literally being solved almost in online poker. And it happened by millions of man hours of people playing and studying on the internet at a volume much, much higher than is happening in live poker. Right. So obviously the game moved super fast, and anyone who was like a good live player from like, you know, 2005 or something that didn't, you know, stay current with the progress of the game, would probably be like terrible at Limit Hold'em now. You know, and then the same thing happened with No Limit. I mean, you look at the way No Limit plays now in six max games, you compare that to, you know, the last time Ivy was playing No Limit online, like, you know, and winning like the get like the pre-Black Friday games, you know, the game, it's like night and day. It's like a completely different game. The game moved forward tremendously. And you know, the same thing is happening in PLO. I mean, all these guys that he's playing, you know, the Benz and Ike and Vroom and Dorbred and all those guys that have been playing those games, I mean, they're working really hard and they're getting better at a really fast rate because they're playing online and they have, you know, tons of hands that they play to review and to get better on. You know, what is Ivy doing to get better at PLO? Like, like poker isn't just like this thing where like he just has it, you know, and he's just got it and he's just gonna always have it. Like, it doesn't work like that. Like, it's a technical game that you have to study and get better at. And you know, games running around him, and it's kind of like I was saying earlier. It's like, yeah, games running around Isildur, that doesn't mean he's a fish. Like, games running around Ivy, it doesn't mean he's like whale status or whatever, but these guys just think they're better than him, so they're playing him, you know? I mean, he could very well be like a top, I don't know, 50 player in the world at PLO or something, but games are going to run around him if he's like the 40th best PLO player in the world or something like that. And yeah, I mean, it's just like the games are moving forward. People are getting better, and that's just how it is, and you can't just expect to, you know, to just always be the best just because you were once the best. And you know, Ivy's like obviously legitimately extremely talented at poker. Since he probably doesn't do that much like studying, he truly has like a gift for it, I would guess. And he's like, you know, extremely like sharp at reading his opponents and learning from his opponents and picking up on strategies that they do. But that doesn't mean that like he can just expect to be better than the best at these games, you know?
Mm-hmm. Who do you think are the best six max guys these days? Because it seems like a lot more six max is running than heads up. If we had to make the power rankings list, where would we got where these days?
I mean, as always, like I said last time, I think like Ike and Sauce and Ben86 are like probably my top players who I would say I try to avoid the most. But, you know, there's lots of other really good players.
I think Broom is like up there. I think he's like one of the best. I mean, you know, there's a lot of guys who have had a lot of success that approach the game kind of differently than I do. And in the past, I think it's been kind of a weakness of mine. I think a lot of people do this, where when somebody approaches the game differently than you, you kind of dismiss them and think that they're not that good, because they clearly, like, you know, you can play a hand against somebody and you think they played wrong, but it's more than that you think they played it wrong. It's more that they clearly thought about how to play this hand in a certain way. It's clearly a part of a certain strategy that they think they have. And it's not just that you think it was wrong. It's more that by them playing that hand a certain way, it indicates to you that they approach a situation differently than you. They think PLO is like, works in a different way than you think it does in this situation, that there are certain factors at play that you don't consider, that they consider, you know. And I think a lot of time I've been guilty of in those spots, just kind of dismissing them, being like, oh, he's wrong in this spot. So, you know, there's guys like in that category, I would say guys like Futek and Barry Sweet, you know, who have like insanely good results, and I find them very difficult to play against, but it's in a very different way that I find like someone like Ben 86 difficult to play against. Like when I play against Ben and he outplays me in a hand or something, my reaction mostly is like to try to copy that in some way in the future, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't necessarily think that when I play against like the Swedes and I think like they kind of own me in a hand. It's more like, how do I counter that strategy? Not like, how do I mimic it? Kind of, because they are coming at it from like a very different angle than I am. So, you know, it's like a little bit harder for me to judge how good they are. Obviously, they're very good. But it's like a little bit more difficult because sometimes like when I see like the way like the first three guys I mentioned are Vroom, sometimes I see the way that they're playing and I'm like, man, they're playing like me, except like much better and much more polished. So it's like easy for me when I think that to then think like they're the best, because obviously like anytime somebody does something the same as you or like in a slightly better version, you're going to think it's like right. And it's like good, because clearly you approach it the same way.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like a little bit difficult for me to like make like a, you know, like a full ranking of all that. But, you know, I still have like a lot of respect for guys who I maybe see the game a little bit differently than.
Would you put someone like Ronnie R has been playing a lot of action? Would you put him in the first category or the second category of players there?
He definitely approaches situations differently than me. Like I don't think we think about PLO in the same way. Based on like a lot of different like ways he plays hands.
Yeah, he has an interesting approach. He disappeared from PLO for a while. I see he's been playing at some 1-2, 2-4 games.
Yeah, I saw him in Monte Carlo this year, and we were playing a bunch of live together. And he said he was like, he thought he was probably done with online poker, but I guess that's not true. This season's playing a ton.
I'm really impressed by the guys like that. Like like Davin used to do that back in the day, where they just like hop in randomly, run up like a $600K, $1 million roll, and then bust it in epic fashion, and then sort of disappear for a little bit, and then come back and do the same thing again a couple times.
Yeah, it's kind of like what Isildur does, except he does it like every 6 days.
He does.
He's the last like 7 years.
Really, I know it's been years now. It isn't like it's been going on 5, 6, 7 years now.
Yeah, it's starting like 2009, right?
When did he show up on Full Tilt? I mean, obviously there's the alleged Untracked Euro Sites activity he's been playing on for years and stuff like that, but I think he showed up on Full Tilt 2008, 2009. Yeah, when did he have that big thing against Stinger? Stinger,
that was 2009. I think like when he smashed Dura, that was like early 2009.
Those were such epic times. There's like some sick YouTube video that sort of takes it back, like the Legend of Isildur. Oh, it's such great.
Oh, yeah, that was from Bet Race Full.
Oh yeah, you're right. I think it was an excerpt from that, from Bet Race Full, I believe.
Yeah.
Man, those were the Dur times, the showdowns there. Isildur playing 8 tables a heads up against 3 opponents at one time at like 501K or 300, 600 or something like that.
Yeah, I think he was playing like 3 against Ivy, 2 against Antonius,
like two against Galfond or something like that, and like one against Deer. You know, it was something insane like that. And I'm pretty sure they were playing both No Limit and PLO, which just makes it even more insane.
Those were the days, man. What do you think about PA's Antonius's latest comment about, what did he say? He said that online PLO now, it's all machines or it's all programs, and he's not going to play because there's all this alleged activity.
Let's find out exactly what he said, because it's actually important, like the wording of what he said. I remember thinking his wording was like actually kind of fair. It wasn't that he was saying that he can't beat it because it's all machines. It was more that, like, I don't remember exactly what it was, but I'm pretty sure he phrased it like in a much more reasonable way than most of the other people that say kind of things like this do.
Okay, he said, you know, it's a little sad, but it looks like technology has advanced so much that it's become a totally different game. Nowadays, players use software that gives them so much information and so much data that it has become more of a game of numbers. I never used any of these programs. I've never used technology to get an edge. I'm more of a field player living in the moments. But the players today know what they're doing. They are basing their play on what the software tells them to do. So it feels like you're playing against a computer these days. If you don't use poker software, it's not a fair game anymore, but I still like to play mixed games.
Okay. He kind of had me for a while until he said the software tells them what to do. Like, that's not, as soon as he's talking about HUDs, that's not what HUDs do. Unless he's talking about like a bot that I don't know about. You know, HUDs don't tell you what to do. And it's just like a common thing that people who don't play online poker or who don't have like a grasp of like what HUDs are or what like software is being used. I don't know what it is, but first of all, like it's like people who just don't play that are saying it. And they're basically, I think to me, they come across as like people who are like ignorant and like afraid of technology in the way that they're talking about it. And they seem to like, it's something that they don't understand and they think it gives people an advantage over them. So they dismiss it as being like wrong or something that like shouldn't exist. And I think they're just doing it because they haven't used it, or it hasn't been a part of their approach or whatever. Like for the most part, you know, getting Poker Tracker and making a HUD is a pretty reasonable and simple process, and the information you get from a HUD is just information. It doesn't tell you what to do. That's just like a really bad way of phrasing it, what he said. Obviously the game is becoming more mathematical, but like I think it's really foolish to dismiss that or to have disdain for that. That's what happens in it. Like this is a game that people are trying to solve. Like people are, in order to get better at this game, you have to try to solve it. And there's situations that need solving. All right. And the way you do that is often by math, you know, and that's like the game. It's a mathematical game and that's how people are trying to get better at it. So, you know, to like have like disdain for that or I don't know, think it's like it's something not good, I think it's really silly, and I think it's just kind of like ignorant of what poker is. And that's not to like dismiss being a field player or anything like that, but it's kind of foolish to just say like, well, I'm a field player, as if the two are mutually exclusive. Okay, like you don't have to, like math players don't like not have feelings when they play, you know, and they make reads on their opponents. They're not just like, they're not using the dream machine and just like, it's not like they're like, they push a button and it's like, what do I do here? It's like, you raised to 46.8% of pot. It's like, that's not what it is. Like, it's not, we're not pawning off our, like, the way it's being presented is almost like the humans are less involved now. The humans are diverting some of their work to a machine to do the work for them. That's not what's happening. Like it's still people interpreting numbers and then making advanced plays based off of it. Like making interpretations of data and then you know, going forward with it. You know, and with all that said, if you wanted to make an argument that like there shouldn't be any HUDs in online poker, I actually would probably agree with that. I'm not saying that I think HUDs are like good for the game or anything. But what I'm saying is that like right now there's an environment where HUDs are allowed and your opponents are going to use them. Therefore, you have to use them to balance out any advantage and not give them an advantage and or to use them better than them and to be better than your opponents. If sites could actually like eliminate HUDs, I would actually probably be in favor of that. I think that's like a cleaner, better way for online poker to exist because it balances out for the amateur players not having that, not using that software. But the issue is that it's probably not possible for them to do that. I mean, like Bovada doesn't even have hand histories and is all anonymous and you can get a HUD on there. what do you think you're going to do if they can't get rid of it there? I don't know if that was like a secret or something. I've just heard that, the rumors about that. Okay.
Allegedly. Anytime you hear a rumor, allegedly you can get a HUD on there. Allegedly you can.
I mean, I don't play on Bovada. I have no idea. But I've just heard that like people are using HUDs on it. It becomes when you've determined that something is completely unenforceable and completely it's something that is accepted by the community and is completely unenforceable by sites to police, then it inherently becomes part of the game. You know, there's nothing stopping Antonius from like learning how to use a HUD. He's a smart guy. It would probably be very quick for me to teach him how to use a HUD and what the information means.
Melly K says, but couldn't you make the argument too that HUD are just like your memory? Because I mean, you will remember a player in person and how they play, but you might not remember a screen name.
So is that saying in support of HUD, or I don't understand what's the point? What point is it?
Personally? I'm not sure. I saw the comment. I thought he had a point when I read it. I'm not sure what the point of the comment is actually. Melly K, Poppy, you're hardcore.
To what he's saying, HUD is only going off information that's already been presented to you. It's not stealing information. I mean, if you use databases, which is not allowed by sites, then yeah, that's gaining an unfair advantage, and that should be policed like anything else that breaks the rules. But going off of information of plays that have happened against you, or players that have played against you, and you're analyzing their play, I mean, it's all information. It's information that's been presented to you. It's not stolen information.
What do you think about, I was looking at the lobby the other day, and you know, it's funny because a couple of years ago, if you looked at the Nolman Hold'em lobby, the 5-10, 10-20, there was no action. PLO, ton of action, so many tables, it was fucking amazing. You're like, these no limit hold'em motherfuckers, they sure took it here, man. I'm glad I made the switch. Now when you look at the lobby on Stars, ton of Zoom, 2-5 Zoom for no limit, ton of 5-10 tables, ton of 10-20 tables, sometimes 25-50 tables. You look at PLO, not much of those same stakes at all. Everyone plays at Zoom. So do you think that Stars should go the route of 25-50 and 5-100 being regular tables? Or do you like how it is only Zoom at 25-50 and 5-100 right now? It just seems like it's not allowing so much action to take place, but it might be allowing more action to take place that might not take place. But it seems like I don't know if it's the best route for PLO to go, is just have it be where all the action's basically Zoom. I'm not saying all the action, obviously there are some regular tables that still run, but yeah, what do you think about that?
I mean, I'm not sure. I mostly am in favor of Zoom. I think Zoom is a more, I think it's just kind of more fair because there's no lobby games. I mean, fair isn't the right word because anyone can play the lobby games, but it, I guess it's cleaner, I guess. If you want to, first of all, I think the playing experience of playing Zoom to me is like fantastic because, you know, you want to play, you get to play. You want to play, you know, four tabling Zoom is like ton of action. Most people probably don't need much more than that. One tabling for like an amateur is like perfectly good. And it's faster and a much more efficient way than playing one table of a regular game. You know, they're just always in a hand. I think for amateur or a regular player, or I mean a pro player, that player experience is nice. I like that you can just sit out and go to the bathroom. I mean, playing like 10 tables. Wait,
what do you do?
Sit out and go to the bathroom. Oh, you pee in the cup?
What do you mean? You sit? Huh? Okay, go, whatever. That seems like an asinine thing to do. Who goes to the bathroom these days? But go ahead, go to the bathroom. Okay, fine, hypothetically.
Yeah, I pee in the catheter. Sometimes when Zoom's not running and I'm playing like 10, 20 deep or something, like the regular tables, and there's like, I'm playing like 8 tables or something, which is kind of a lot for me because I'm pretty slow. And I have to go take a piss or I want to just like take a 5-minute break just to like walk around for a second. Like, it's really annoying to have to like sit out all the tables. It takes like 5 minutes to sit out all of your tables, and to sit back in takes a while to get all your action. You know, it's like a whole process. In Zoom, it's just like right away, you're done. You come back, you're back playing in like a minute. So in terms of that, I think Zoom is like better. The obvious arguments against Zoom are that it dilutes the amateur players much more between the regs. So like you'll have like 10 regs all playing 4 tables, and then one amateur playing 1 table. And so obviously everyone's win rate collapses to a very small number, and to some people just start losing. But that isn't necessarily an argument against it. I think that's kind of a complicated question about what is best for the poker economy, what is best for the players, what's best for the site. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what's, I think everyone loves to speak authoritatively about what's best for online poker.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Everybody's certain that they know what is best and what is wrong and how to fix everything. I don't know how to fix most of these things. In terms of Zoom, for my personal playing experience, I like Zoom and I like the transition to Zoom. And I'm pretty happy having Zoom to play. If Stars got rid of the 25, 50, and 1500 Zoom pools, which I don't think they'll ever do, it just doesn't seem like that's happening. But if they did that and they went back to the normal, I mean, I don't know, I would just deal with it and play the normal tables. I don't know, I would... it does seem like a lot of amateur players prefer regular tables to Zoom. But then there's some that prefer Zoom. I really don't know. But to what you're saying earlier, I just looked at a lobby. It seems like there's way more Nolimit, or way more PLL right now than Nolimit. There's like nothing in Nolimit at all.
Is there?
Yeah. There's like 2 5-10 tables, and one of them's cap.
Mm.
Just a bunch of cap. Mm. And a full ring 10-20 Nolimit. Oh, man.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of, action running right now.
10-20 Nolimit. That brings me back.
10-20 Nolimit? The seat scripters have it so good in these 200, 400 games, man.
Yeah, they do. But, you know, anyone can get a script, so.
That's true. You scripting? You seat script yet?
No. But I don't really know.
Why not get it at this point in time? If you look at something like this, 200, 400 games running around, 3 of the guys are scripters that are in the game.
Yes. Sierra, Grubo, and Devline.
Yeah.
Bill, whatever. Yeah, I mean, if you can't beat him, join him.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't even know if there's anything you can do about the whole scripting situation. Obviously, everyone says ban scripts. And it seems like there's some people who do use them. There's some people who sort of refuse. They don't want to use them. And
I mean, refusing at this point is really silly, because the argument you make for refusing, which in the early days of scripting might make some sense, was that you don't want to create that environment for the amateurs where they sit and then boom, it fills up, right? You don't want to contribute to that, is like the argument, right? Mm. But at this point, it makes no difference, because there's enough scripters that happens regardless. Adding a few more scripters makes no difference if that happens or not, right? So at this point, like, I mean, what the hell's even the difference?
Do you feel like more of the regulars are doing it now, or are there some guys who, like, I guess it's usually the more guys who are like the more notable guys, the guys who are a lot more respected in the community. Those guys tend not to script, and then you find the guys who are a little bit less respected are the ones who are scripting, who are the third person sitting out at the tables, who are camping on the, like, those are the type of players that do those sort of like borderline things that people look at and they don't necessarily have that much respect for.
Yeah, that might be the case. I'm not really sure if that's, I mean, I don't know, maybe. But, you know, it's just like, you see it like on Tubeless 2 in the PLO forum, everyone loves to just like rip on like Dan Fu and like all the other scripters. And they call them like scumbags and this and that. And like, I try to stay out of it, but I've made a few posts before. Like that's just not a good approach. Like, you know, calling somebody a scumbag doesn't make them a scumbag. And just because you don't like something doesn't make it wrong. Like PokerStars is explicitly allowed scripts. So what are they doing that's scummy? You know? And it's just a situation where, like, if you want to discuss why scripts are bad, you need to come up with, like, a comprehensive and, like, argumentative, like, presentation about why it's bad and have show, like, with, like, logic and reason why it's bad and try to convince PokerStars to do something about it. Just, like, berating the scripters doesn't do anything. I mean, a lot of people have like a lot of contempt for Stars for like a lot of reasons, and rake is too high and they think they don't listen to the players and whatever. But then instead of like focusing any energy that they have, that they use, on at least trying to communicate with Stars and trying to do something productive with them, they just devote it to like bitching at each other or whatever. When literally just like, even if they wrote an email to Stars with the same content of what they want to say, it at least has a chance of like influencing them. Cause I mean, they do listen somewhat. I'm like, it certainly seems like they used to listen more and now it's gotten a little bit worse. But like, I mean, I know like some people, like there's like, you know, an issue of camping at high stakes sometimes. And I talk with like a bunch of high stakes PLO players and they like will message me like, oh, look at this. Like Illery is camping at 100, 200 right now. I'm like, yeah, did you email Stars? They're like, no. I'm like, it takes you the same amount of time to message me and I am meaningless. Just fucking message Stars because it's against the rules. And if you report somebody, they will give them a warning at least. Maybe they won't ever do anything significant. They won't ban them, but they'll eventually send them an email and telling them like, if you keep doing this, we're going to ban you for a week. And if you keep doing it even more, we're going to ban you for a month. That's happened to in No Limit. That's how they like cleaned up the camping in No Limit. But all the PLO players do is they just like bitch to each other about it for some reason. I don't know why.
Well, I know PokerStars did listen to the community when they, obviously the botting situation, they listened to the community by banning data mining from the Zoom table so that you're able to identify those bots in the future. So, I mean, they're listening to the problems and the feedback. They're just doing things that might not be liked by the players.
The data mining thing is a weird thing because it seems obvious that you shouldn't have sites out there data mining. Like, the, you know, that's like, that seems like a fine policy for the site to not have, just independent of anything else. Just like, you don't want people, because using, like, being able to download hands that you didn't play is against the rules. You don't want people to do that. It gives them an unfair advantage or whatever, right? So that's like fine approach Stars to have. The only issue with that is that many of the cheating scandals over the years that have been exposed from, like, I mean, I'm talking years back, all the cheating scandals, big ones that have been exposed, like the botting one, there was the Stocks Trader and Little Zen, remember that, No Limit one?
Which one?
Like Stocks Trader.
Trader one. Yeah, I remember that one. That one was pretty big.
No. That was exposed through PTR.
Wasn't there a guy that got arrested for something that was and that was that separate? That might have been 888.
That was something else. That was 888. Okay. Multi-accounting and maybe colluding, I think. There's been a bunch of others, and like, you know, imagine if there was a database back in the UV days, how much faster they would have been discovered, the super users, if there was like a data mining site. So it's, the problem is, yes, while it's very reasonable for them to want to ban data mining sites, the problem is that right now, the players are at least, if not more important as a means of protecting the integrity of the games than the security team themselves at the sites. So it's an interesting spot, and it's, I don't know. I think the games are probably less safe without
without data mining.
It seems comical that they would have made this change. Honestly, like when I heard the change, I was like, you gotta be like, really? This is their response to the botting situation?
That was their response? Like, they didn't say that as like a direct response.
Wester seems like that's their response. They ban the ability to find these people in the future.
Yeah, that's, I mean, if that's, I don't know, like I didn't follow like the timeline of the events, but if that's what happened, that's pretty messed up.
I mean, they didn't really make any other response. I don't know if there's been refunds. Has there been even refunds or people gotten money back from that situation?
I don't know. I haven't gotten anything, but I heard it wasn't at high stakes. It was only at mid stakes.
Are you worried about a potential botting situation at the high stakes games?
In theory, yes. I haven't like come across anything that has made me worried, but I imagine it's something that might happen eventually.
Yeah. I mean, I never would have, honestly, it was never on my mind to think that the biggest 1-2, 2-4 winners on PokerStars would be, I never, it was something I'd worried about, never something I thought about, it crossed my mind. Obviously here, the bot situation, you know, Nolan and Hold'em or the Montenegro bots or the Catalomino bots, or I made that word up, but I never thought that it would have happened at Stars. And then, you have this thread, there's 10 plus names on there. It just seems crazy that.
Yeah. I don't know what PokerStars' burden of proof is for enforcing rules. But it seems to me that they're very hesitant to take like punitive action on accounts based solely on stat similarities. And I know this because, well, for one, there was a whole bot thing, and like if they believed in like tracking similar accounts that have like super similar stats in every situation, that would be something they could do like as like an automated thing, right? Mm-hmm. They would be able to just like, they should be able to have like algorithms that track when like two accounts are playing too similarly to each other, you know? If you have like a, if you imagine like a, as like all the different accounts playing PLO as like a scatter plot of like data points, you know, if there's like some that are, if there's just like all of a sudden like a clump that are in one section that are all exactly the same, and then everybody else is like distributed in like a normal way, that would be very suspicious, right? Mm-hmm. That would be something that they should be able to detect on their own. But to my knowledge, they don't seem like they are, I don't know what it is, but see, this is one of the problems with catching cheaters and punishing cheaters. The Stars, first of all, they don't ever publish the names of people who they've caught, right? So it's harder for, so that denies us information as players on how to protect ourselves in the future, because we might know the account holder, we might know accounts that are associated with that account holder. And secondly, I know that there's a big difference that they have between banning an account and letting them cash out, and banning an account and confiscating their money. And the burden of proof that they want for cheating, for confiscating their money, is obviously much higher than they want for just banning them and telling them to leave, which is fair, obviously. If you're going to take somebody's money, you need a higher burden of proof that they did something wrong. My impression is that they think that the burden of proof needed goes beyond just comparing stats, and I have several reasons to believe that. One of the main ones is that, because when I've reported people for multi-accounting, where I had like four accounts, I was like, these are the same person, like I guarantee it, and I showed them stats. They basically didn't seem to think that I was showing them something significant enough. And it seems like that's also the case for the bots, I guess. I don't know what exactly. It seems like there's something, I assume they're still investigating it. Is that what they say?
Thank you more.
Yeah, I kind of stopped keeping up.
Yeah, me too. I don't really open the thread anymore. I mean, it's just, I don't have many high hopes in terms of something getting resolved from that. I don't even know how long it's been now. I feel like it's been before the series, so it's been months, and you know, we haven't really heard too much back. I mean, I imagine the accounts are, I think their accounts are closed down, but I would imagine they're back. They're somewhere. They re-educated themselves. All right, like, let's not make you fucking 10 accounts do this same detectable thing that now we can't detect anymore because they took away the ability to detect that. So,
yeah, but you know, and also the thing is, like, for all stars will do about it, you know, everyone loves to hate on stars, but the truth is they're by far the best we have, and they actually will enforce some things. Like, I have no faith whatsoever in, like, party poker or, like, eye poker to do anything, you know?
888 poker to some extent.
888 seems to be trying.
Yeah. We'll take some questions, guys. You guys got them in the chat. I'll give some shout-outs. I haven't given shout-outs, man. It's been a while. Hold on a second. Just to answer, for camping, camping means when you have a player who's waiting heads up at 100, 200, 200, 400 table on stars.
No, not exactly. You're allowed to camp heads up. You're not allowed to camp free-handed.
Those right. Are the rules. Okay, so you can have one person sit out, but when so you have a guy playing ready for action, someone else sits out, a third person can't come and sit out. So what is it, like a race for the second person to be the one to sit out or something?
No, it's in theory, it's supposed to be a hierarchy. So if two of the three players are willing to play three-handed, but the third isn't, that guy has to go.
Oh, okay. Does that work out always like that?
No, it doesn't.
Right. Like, I'm sure, like, Scared Boy probably sits down and he's like, I'll play. And then they sit in and doesn't play or something like that. Like, what happens in that situation?
If the two players, like, if two people are playing heads up and there's a third guy sitting there and he's sitting out, that's camping and that's not allowed. So if they start playing and the third guy doesn't play, he has to go. But if it's just one person who's sitting in and one person sitting out, that's allowed.
Okay. Poker, oh, that's not a question. It's not a question either. Ask him about the unreleased 2 months, 2 million pilot episode that Kranz talked about once.
Yeah, I think I talked about this in the last podcast, but
talked about it too, yeah.
The unreleased pilot was filmed with Brian, Jay, Emil, and Ariel, and not me. Ariel was the original fourth cast member. And it was filmed in Vegas in like September of 08 or something like that, or August of 08. And that was back when like nosebleeds were like alive and well and thriving, and all the guys were playing like 200, 400 and stuff. And I think it was better than 2 months, 2 million. It was a little bit more documentary style, less kind of like reality show nonsense. I haven't seen it in years. I saw it like before 2 months, 2 million aired. But I remember really liking it and thinking it was really good. I don't know if it'll ever surface. I really have no idea what's going on there. I can't hear you.
Sorry, now you can.
Okay.
Yeah, so there you go. Not with Poker Central, the 24-hour poker channel coming up. Maybe there'll be a new reality style television show in the works here. Maybe it could be based in Vancouver or Toronto. We take I don't know. Maybe the Evil Empire 2 months, 2 million heads up takeover challenge or some shit like that.
Yeah, I mean, I would watch it. I don't think I would do another show, but I would definitely watch one.
There's a lot of. I'm really surprised there's this many 2 months, 2 million questions from people.
You know, I still constantly get like asked about 2 months, 2 million, and even, like when I'm in Vegas or just even like on Twitter. I'm always impressed at the staying power of 2 months, 2 million. It's like people are still really interested in it. I guess, I mean, it was the only show of its kind, really. The only poker reality show that, like, really made it to there. There's always been, like, talk of, like, 10 other shows that never happened.
Right. I mean, that show was great. It was like, a really good show. It was really entertaining. It still has replay value now. I feel like if you watch it back now, you're still going to be entertained. Like, it's still a fun show to watch.
What else is being asked? I can't see the chat. How do I do that?
You can either go to YouTube, the link that I put on Twitter, and or Twitch.
Okay, so what else is being asked?
It's mostly stuff I've discussed either with you or with Jay before on the cast. So ask about the session Jay played versus Pfeiffer and 2 months, 2 million. Yeah, was that Pfeiffer session set up on 2 months, 2 million? Like, we've already talked about that stuff before on past podcasts, but it was, yeah, talk, I guess we can answer the question again. It's a pretty easy answer. Jonah Louis said,
yeah, I see that one. I see that question.
Any chance of a dick off between the two of you? No doubt, Anthony got a nice chunky Jewish package.
Very, very professional.
Dear God, I love, man. That's like a Twitch comment. You must be from Twitch, Jonah. Shout out to you, Jonah, for that. And that was the first comment Anski saw in the chat. So, does Anski have any career goals other than poker in the future? Danny Huntley asks.
In the near future, no. I have no other. Right now, I'm fully focused on poker. I would like to branch off and do some other things at some point in life. But I have no plans in the near future. So, you know, for right now, I think, you know, focusing on just being a poker player is like the best thing I can do for myself, because that's what I'm going to be doing for the next few years. And any energy I divert away from poker to something else, I think, I kind of think you should just, you know, be like completely, fully like committed to what you're doing, you know, and then when you want to switch to do something else, then completely, fully immerse in that. I mean, at least for something like poker, where I think if I'm not like focused enough in it, I'm not going to be able to compete, because everybody I'm competing with is fully focused.
And I've been thinking a lot about that lately, because I've been playing much more poker now, but I'm also trying to do other things with the gym and with dieting and with, you know, podcastings and Twitch, stuff like that. And it's definitely...
Yeah, those that's a little different, though. I'm not saying you can't go to the gym if you're focused on poker.
Oh, okay. So you're saying not, because like that's a focus. I mean, for me, that's a big focus. Like dieting is like a huge thing to focus on.
I'm talking about like career path, like...
Oh, career-wise. Okay. So if you're saying like have a business and play poker, basically.
Yeah, I'm not saying you can't. I'm just saying it's a challenge that I'm not like willing to take on right now.
Okay. No, because I mean, I'm just talking about just in general, like doing general things. Like it seems like lately I've just been playing poker. I haven't really been keeping much up with my diet. I've been working out pretty solidly, but at the same time, I don't know, just poker all the time. And obviously, I think the results have shown that it's been really good. But when it's not 100% focused on poker, the results just aren't as good. It's so, I don't know. I really want to know how people do it that can have these other things that they can put it all into and then get back to poker and still do well at poker.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of really impressive people in the poker world that have had tons of success and done other things and been successful. It's, you know, poker is hard enough, and there's some people who just seem to just crush it at everything.
What do you think your life's going to change at all when the marriage is official in 3 weeks? Or do you think everything's going to be the same in terms of the way you approach poker and the way you approach things you're doing right now?
I don't think anything will change with that. I mean, we've been living together for 4 years or something like that. 3 years. 4 years. So like my whole life is not going to change at all. I mean, if anything, I'm like more motivated, as a result of like my home and family life, because I feel like I'm responsible for, you know, providing a better future and things like that. I'm not just like, you know, I'm always somebody who's like I'm way more likely to be self-destructive than to fuck somebody else up, basically, you know? So having like, more on my shoulders probably makes me a better poker player and a better person, because it makes me more focused.
Thomas asks a really good question. Anski, do you ever feel wistful? Do you ever feel wistful regret about getting so deep into and good at poker that you can't really change your career path because it is so profitable?
Yeah, that's a good question. No, I don't. I'm pretty passionate about poker. I really love poker and I love being a poker player. So I don't feel regret about it. That would be silly for me to Because first of all, it's not like I ever had a clear alternative. Like poker was just kind of always like from right when I started becoming an adult, poker was like always there. Mm-hmm. And it's not like I was like, man, I could be a great marine biologist, but I'm going to play poker instead, you know? Like, now I like long for marine biology. No, it's not really it, you know? And the only other thing that I'm at all good at in life, basically, is cooking. So cooking as like a career path is not probably the best idea. It's a very, very difficult career path and pays very little for a very long time. And most people are kind of miserable and work long hours and it's very unhealthy and it's just not a good lifestyle. But in terms of like my poker life, I mean, even in my biggest downswings and when I'm like feeling very sorry for myself and I'm like all pissy about poker, I still never think like, oh, like I wish I wasn't a poker player. I never think that, or I can't wait to get out of poker. I really never think that. I'm still quite content being a poker player. And I feel a great sense of like satisfaction when I play a long session and even if I don't necessarily win, but I think I played well, or I'm like happy with my performance and my ability to keep going or whatever. I feel like at the end of that session, I feel good. I feel like I did my duty. I went to work and there's like a certain joy I have in just doing my fucking job, you know, like, and that feels kind of good sometimes. I don't think poker is like something to, I take pride in it. I don't think it's something like petty and like stupid and it's just like some silly game, you know. I think it's like a very intellectually stimulating game, and I think it's a battle of wits, and having, accomplished something, like accomplishing something in poker, I think is like very worthy of being proud of. I certainly don't think it's like a silly game that we play and we're wasting our time, you know. If down the road I find an opportunity to do something other than poker and I can get passionate and get behind it, then I'll do that. But if poker stays good and I can keep making money at it and keep doing well, then I'll keep doing it. I'm certainly not setting any timelines or setting any like sort of goals of what needs to happen before I get out of poker or something like that. I'm just going to take it year by year and see what opportunities present itself, you know? Like a lot of my friends have been kind of drifting into DFS because that's better for them right now.
Who isn't into DFS now, Ansi? Yeah, every day there's a new poker player providing analysis for DFS. So it's.
Yeah, I'm not into it. It's kind of like what I was saying earlier. When it first started getting big and all my friends started getting into it, I was thinking, maybe this is what I should do. But I kind of felt like, no, like, you know, focus on playing PLO and getting better at PLO. That's the best thing you can do right now.
You ever played the game? We started a new game last time. It's called Two Truths, One Lie. God, I should have fucking thought about this too. It's where you say two truths about yourself and one lie, and the other person has to guess which part is the lie and which, they have to guess the lie. You ever played this game before?
Yes, I have.
Okay. Would you like to play? Let's play. All right.
Okay.
Who's you go asking? First or I go first? I don't mind. I haven't thought about this at all, unfortunately, so I don't have any GTO things. God, the last one was great. I remember that one, what I said now.
Okay.
Okay.
It takes like a few minutes to think of good ones.
It does. Let me think about it for a second. Okay.
And the problem is, like, like, a decent amount about me. Like, if you were a total stranger, I could have some good ones, you know? Like,
it's a very good point.
I was on a reality show. Like, I would have a good one to sneak in.
That's a good point. All right, hold on. Okay, got one. Okay. Okay.
Should have prepared for this.
Okay. Maybe I need to prepare people in the morning. I know I like. I'm gonna get one. I got two lined up right now. I'm gonna go with the same theme for all of my things. Okay. I'm gonna do. Mine are all the same theme. All right. I got three.
Okay.
Man, this is bad. I shouldn't. I forgot how many people watch these things. Maybe I shouldn't say this one. All right. Fuck it. I'm gonna say this one. Okay. Two truths, one lie. Oh, it's two truths, one lie. I had two lies, one truth. Shit. All right, I'm going to do two lies, one truth. I'm going to say three things and two are a lie, one's the truth, okay?
Okay.
All right, I once went to a music festival, a three-day music festival, and I didn't sleep all 3 days. Instead, I partook in extracurricular use during those 3 days, staying up all night, and it was a bad time. The second one is I once stayed up in a hotel room for multiple days on different mixtures of extracurricular activities, playing poker on the internet and raging at the same time with a friend. And the third one is that I once took Adderall for a poker session and I didn't want to sleep and I was trying to chase losses that I ended up playing a 62-hour session, keep taking more and more Adderall.
The last two are so similar. This is kind of bullshit.
No. Oh, wait. Yeah. No, that one's Adderall. The second one is like, it's like hardcore partying at the same time and mixing poker in between.
Oh. I don't know.
I don't know. This is what came to my mind for some reason. I'm not sure why.
All right. I would assume, the first one was true. 3 days at a music festival.
Nope, the second one's definitely true. Okay, that was the.
Okay.
That was the truth. Wait, I'm supposed to have you guess again. Damn it! Fuck! I fucked up the game. I'm sick at this game, honestly. But yeah, the second one's the truth.
Okay, what were you playing?
What?
What games were you playing?
25, 50, 50, 100.
Okay. Seems like a good time to be on a bunch of drugs.
I lost a lot of money during that time. No surprise. But that's the truth, unfortunately. Okay, your turn. Go ahead.
Oh shit! I don't have any.
What do people in chat say? The middle one's fake. First is fake. First one false. All true.
All right, I have to go to the bathroom. I'll think about this.
Okay, go ahead. Go to that. I'm gonna get some shout-outs. Who we got out there, guys? I gotta get better at that game. Who we got on YouTube, man? We got my boy Danny Huntley. What's up, puppy? Luke McCullough. What up, Luke? Scott Sanders. What up, Scott? Costio Tolios. What up, puppy? We got a guy named Joe. What up, Joe? What up, Joe? What up, puppy? Javier Gomez Morales. What is up, Javier Gomez Morales? What's up, papito? Calamosa Calamoracita. We got on Twitch, man. We got Cream to Raisin, Nosy Aces, Zapita, my boy Greg from Brazil, Hero Value. What's up, boys? Derek Castillo, Papi, A Papi, Robust Espresso, Razin, Pierre Menards, Wally Gee, Never Never. What the fuck kind of name is that, boy? Meeks, what up, Meeks? East Coast Grinder, what up, Papi? Hans Poker, what up, Hans? My boy TJ, what up, Tej? What up, kid? Costas Pavaritos, what up? Costas Pavaritos. Darth Wager, what up, Darth? Got that Twitch, what up, kid? All caps, so wait, says, can you sing my, say my name? Josh, what up, Josh? Aaron Banks, Poppy, Brokski, Ludwig, Nikki. All right, Anski's back.
Okay. So it's two truths, one lie, right?
Correct.
Okay. I am afraid of flying. I am afraid of needles. I am afraid of tentacles.
What does that mean? Tentacles? What does that mean?
Octopus, squid, jellyfish.
Shit. Flying, needles, or an octopus. One of those is a lie. Well, it's not octopus because you never would have made. You ever would have said that if it was, that was false. Although, if you're like sick leveler, you're really you're playing at an unfair level if that's the case. So it's not tentacles. This is close spot. I wish I could ask like a question about the two. It's got to be. I mean, it doesn't have to be one of the. Oh man, it's. I think it's. I think it's you're afraid of flying.
You think that's the lie?
Two truths, one lie. That's the lie. No, man, it's just. Yeah, that's the lie.
Nope.
God, it's needles, motherfucker. It's so sick. God damn it. Fuck. All right, why are you afraid of needles, Poppy?
No, I'm not afraid of needles.
What are you talking about? You, how sick are you, man? It's really the tentacles?
But no, no, no. Tentacles are, is true. Flying right. is true. Needles is the lie. I'm not afraid of needles. You said flying is the lie. Flying is a truth. Tentacles is a truth.
Okay, so you're not afraid of needles.
I'm not afraid of needles. But I am afraid of flying, and I am afraid of tentacles.
Okay, okay, wait. I had it reversed. I had it reversed. I had the two truths. I thought you were afraid of flying and you weren't afraid of needles and tentacles.
Well, that's because you did two false or two lies and one truth in yours, but it was supposed to be a lie.
Okay, so you aren't afraid of needles.
I'm not afraid of needles, no.
That's weird. So you're afraid of flying.
I'm afraid of flying, yeah.
Really? Why is that?
I have no idea. It's an irrational fear. I mean, I know why. I know when it started. I'm afraid of, I don't know why I'm afraid of tentacles. I'm not like really afraid of it. I wouldn't like freak out or something, but like, I really, really don't like octopus and squid and jellyfish, like as a creature. And my nightmare death would be like crashing in an airplane and then getting like strangled by an octopus to death. That would be pretty bad.
Christopher says flies to Mexico and does scuba. Yeah, it seems like two interesting things that.
Well, I fly all the time. I fly all the time because I'm a logical person and I know that fear of flying is irrational, but I can't control it. So I just do it anyway and force myself. Like I don't let it like affect my life, but I'm like quite afraid of flying. And I get a lot of anxiety from flying. And it's, I mean, that's what, like an irrational, like you can't control it. You know, like I know that flying is safe. It's a conscious thing that I know that it's fine. And I know that, and I never let it affect my decision-making of whether or not I'm gonna fly somewhere. I fly all the time. I travel a lot for programs, but I still get like a lot of anxiety from it every time.
I always remind myself whenever I get scared of flying that it's all a math problem. And the math says that you're very unlikely to die in a plane accident or get hurt in a plane. So I always go back to math and I calm myself down a bit when I start getting a little bit of anxiety.
Yeah. It goes up and down sometimes. It depends on the flight. It depends on like the situation, I guess. I remember exactly, I know when it started though. I used to not be afraid at all. And then I was on a flight that was taking off and this is like 5 years ago or something. And it's taking off through a storm, like through pretty heavy clouds. And it was like very turbulent. And all of a sudden there's a flash of light outside the window. And like the loudest like cracking like explosion sound I've ever fucking heard. Like deafening loudness to it. And everybody started screaming on the plane, like freaking out. Like the woman next to me started like hyperventilating and looked like she was gonna pass out. And I like looked out the window and like the plane is still there, like the engine's still there. I'm like, what the fuck was that? And it was, I mean, it was fucking scary. And the flight, like, is just, it's still going up. I can feel it going up. I'm like, we're not going down. I don't know what the hell's going on. And like a minute later, a stewardess comes down the aisle. You know, we're only like a couple minutes after takeoff. Like they wouldn't have been standing yet normally. And a stewardess comes down the aisle and is just like asking people, like, did you guys see which side of the plane the light flashed on. And I was just like, yeah, it was on this side. Like, and some guy on the other side of the plane is like, I don't know, I think I saw it over here. I was like, it was on this side of the plane. and then she's like, okay, and walks back. And everybody's still just like, what the fuck? What is going on? Because nothing is actually wrong with the plane so far. But that happened. And the way the stewardess asked that question. And then we, I'm holding a corkscrew for some reason. And like 5 minutes later, after it happened, the pilot comes on the intercom, and, you know, and like the pilot voice is just like, hello folks. You may have noticed that a loud, crashing sound, 5 minutes ago, that was just a little bit of lightning that hit the side of the plane. Nothing to worry about. Lightning hits planes all the time. They're designed for it. So, sit back and enjoy the flight, and we'll have you at 30,000 feet in no time. It's like, thanks for waiting 5 minutes to tell us, like, 5 minutes of fucking, like, hell, and the woman next to me, like, screaming in hysterics. And it was weird. Like, it scared me, like, initially, like, really, like, it gave me, like, a shock. But once I calmed down, I was, like, fine. And I didn't really think about it that much. But then ever since then, every time I got on a plane, I would start getting like really tense and not just like when I get on, but like days before, even sometimes when I know I have a flight, I start getting really like anxious and feeling like a lot of just like nervousness at it.
Wow. Did it ever stop you from going somewhere?
No, it's never stopped me from going anywhere. If I have a trip planned, I'll fly. I've made a conscious like decision, like I will not let this like affect my life, because that's just such like a donkey thing to do, just to like let it, because the thing is, like, I know that there's nothing wrong with flying. It's not like I think flying is unsafe, you know. I just force myself to do it, and I mostly self-medicate with booze.
Don't people take Xanax or something like Xanax. That?
Yeah, Xanax. I've taken Xanax before. It helps. The only reason I don't usually like taking Xanax is Xanax is so fucking powerful that like when I get off the plane, I'm still like fucked up. And like a lot of time I'm flying to a poker tournament and like I don't want to have like that in my system like when I'm going to be playing like a little bit later, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not like playing the same day I land, but like, I don't know, sometimes I've taken Xanax and I sleep for like 20 hours. Like, it's just like so powerful.
I might try that sometimes.
It affects me really strongly. But mostly I just have a few drinks before I get on the plane.
Have a few whiskeys and something.
Yes. Quite a few whiskeys before getting on the plane.
I gotta go. I'm drinking honestly a lot of water. I gotta go. I'm gonna ask you about your poker trips. If you have any poker trips planned for this year, for the rest of the year, or coming into early next year.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm gonna go to Vegas probably for Five Diamond for the WPT in December. Not doing Malta or World Series Europe. Going to Vegas in December, I'm kind of looking forward to just get a break from Canadian winter and maybe play some live cash and play the 10K at Bellagio. All right, I'm going to read the comments now. Waluigi says, if I was scared of flying, I would just take a big batch of heroin.
Oh man, welcome to the comments, Poppy. It's a great place to be. Go ahead. No, keep going. Read some more comments.
Okay.
I would just take a big batch of heroin.
I don't know. That was the best one.
Needle in the eye or flight around the world with Zimbabwe Airlines.
that's,
That's a good one. I don't know. I don't think I can make that decision.
I'm going with the flight around the world with Zimbabwe Airlines.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah. They'll probably be okay.
Needle in the eye. What cash games do you expect to run, play, and when you are in Vegas for Five Diamond in December?
I really have no idea. I haven't been there in years. So I don't really know. Maybe nothing's going to run. If nothing runs, whatever, I'll just play the tournaments and get some relaxing time in Vegas and eat some good sushi for fucking once. Maybe, I don't know, maybe some 1500 or 2550 or something will run. Get a little bit of action. I mostly think traveling for live poker tournaments is not really worth my time compared with playing online for the most part, but it's part of like my routine to just mix it up, and it keeps me fresh and doing something different. So, you know, just going and playing like a little bit live 2550 might just feel good, you know.
That's a pretty good point. There's no high stakes peel out runs in Vancouver, right? Edgewater has some, but not very often.
Yeah, I'd be surprised if any high stakes are in. I think I've like looked on like the Bravo app, and there's like 1-2 running sometimes.
Yeah, I always look at the Bravo app for here in Chicago, but now there's been a bunch of the WSOP circuit events in town, so I might. Yeah. There's a PLO event tomorrow. I'm excited to play. I love PLO tournaments now. Like I love them after Vegas. So I'm really excited to play a live PLO tournament.
Wait, you're going to play the where?
It's a World Series of Poker circuit event here in Chicago.
Oh yeah, in Hammond.
In Hammond, yeah. What's running? 5-10 PLO. Yeah. I'm excited about that. So that's your traveling, and no Aussie Millions, no PCA, anything like that?
Oh, I'm going to go to PCA probably. I pretty much always go to PCA. As far as poker trips go, it's one of the like most condensed, like action packed trips. Like every single day you can play like 2 high stakes tournaments basically. Almost. And they really like condense the schedule. So there's just like always something going on. Like I can go like the first day, play like the 100K, then the next day, there's like a 5K, then the next day there's like a 50K, then the main starts and there's like a 5K. There's a 5K almost every single day. Then on the end of the trip, there's 2 to 10K turbos. It's just like an insane amount of action that you can get in, which is like kind of one of the reasons playing live sucks is you don't get in that much action because you bust and you have to wait a day to play like your next tournament, you know. But they do a good job of like packing in as much as they possibly can. So I pretty much always go to PCA. I'll probably go this year again.
What's the process like for getting money at PCA?
It's the easiest, best thing in the world. You can just take it out of your account. They'll just give you cash.
Okay. So a lot of people have cash running around down there then basically.
Yeah, there's tons of cash down there. It's not, you know, a lot of the issues with some live tournaments is getting cash there and getting converting money and all that.
Yeah.
Like World Series Europe right now, it's like kind of a disaster. There's insane fees on wiring money in.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't buy it online, obviously, because it's a World Series thing. They're not partnered with Stars or anything like that. So it's kind of like a disaster, and PCA is like the best. You just
Anski, can you read this last comment, please?
This Zeus's comment?
I just want to hear. Yeah,
I'm not gonna say that.
Oh my gosh, Anski, where are you bringing these people out today? Is that Ben 86's troll account?
Huh?
That might be Ben 86 said he has a troll account he uses.
Oh, really?
Yeah, could be him.
That could be him. That seems like his style.
It seems like Ben 86's troll would say something like that. All right, guy. Take it easy. We got anything else we want to add right now, Anski? We got anything else we want to talk about? We hit on most things, I think.
I don't have anything.
You excited for the wedding? You pumped up?
Yeah, very pumped.
Where's the wedding at?
It's in Florence.
Florence, Italy?
Yeah.
GTO, Poppy. Who? How many people you got going out there?
There's going to be 87 people on the way.
Holy shit. Are you paying for any of them people to fly out? Or are they all paying out, flying on their own dime out there?
No, they got to get themselves there.
Okay, yeah, you're like, yeah, no shit. No. Well, I'm guessing they probably bought it a long time ago then.
Mm-hmm.
It's awesome, man. That'll be fun.
Yeah.
Official, is she going to be Stephanie Stern, or is it keep her last name or what?
She's changing her name.
Hmm. Well, I'm looking forward to the photos. Is your best man, is it a poker player, or is it someone outside of poker?
It's my brother. I have an older brother.
Was your brother at the World Series of Poker playing tournaments every single day this summer?
No, I know who you're talking about. That's
fucking
not
guy. I keep seeing the guy. One time I'm like, what's up? I'm like, Yansky, what are you doing? He's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, oh shit, never mind. I was like, why do you look just like Anski? It's absurd. The guy's in the Rio every day. It's so sick. He's there all the time.
His name is Andy. He's from Florida. And yes, we know about this, and we both look very similar. And he, like, for years I had never met him, but I'd heard about him. Like, people would always be like, yo, you know, there's a guy who plays poker who looks exactly like you. And so many different people would say this. And I was just kind of like, yeah, or whatever, you know. And then in PCA this year, I was playing cash, and he sat down at the table. I was like, hey, are you the guy that looks like me? He's like, yeah. I was like, yeah, I guess so. It makes sense.
Wait a second. Is he one of those Florida ballers that was in the NVG thread about how are Miami pros still baller? Is that one of the ballers?
I'm not sure. He might have been in there. I didn't really read that thread.
Yeah, that'd be great. I really hope he's one of the ballers.
I think
Stinger said he's from Florida. I remember I asked him, I was like, who the fuck's that guy? Like, it looks just like Donnie. It's tripping me out. I kept seeing the guy everywhere. One time I was at the Aria at that Mexican place there. I turn around, he's sitting right there. I'm like, what the fuck is this guy following me around here? Shout out to that guy, man. Shout out to Andy. He plays at the Hard Rock Dunk place. Says, yeah, he certainly might be the guy. Could be the guy. I think that's all we got. Guys, next week we're going to have a legend of the poker world, Haralabob Vulgaris, on the podcast. I think that's going to be on Wednesday, I believe. And we're also going to have Jeff Gross on hopefully Monday, but we'll see what happens. You have any two podcast recommendations for us, Anski? I don't know if I got the ones on last time or not.
Sure. How about Isildur?
Two podcast recommendations for people I can try to get on. That might come on, actually.
Isildur is just no shot.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like I have to meet Isildur in person.
He's
like, I have to see him in person and then talk with him in person, then ask him in person. Because people in person say yes, are more inclined to say yes.
I mean, he's done some media stuff before. Not much, but like a couple of things probably.
I don't even know how to get in touch with Isildur. Like, I'm not sure if I talk to his.
You'll just have to play 200 or 400 with him and then ask him in the chat.
Maybe I could have someone else play 200 or 400 with him and ask him in the chat.
Yeah. Matt Kirk, somebody in chat wrote Matt Kirk. That's not a bad one.
Matt Kirk, okay.
He's a character.
Write this down, Matt Kirk.
You gotta get Stealth Monk on.
Now listen. So I watched the World Series of Poker main events episodes.
No?
I mean, I'm not sure I want to have him on. You know, I don't know. It kind of freaked me out a little bit watching him on the television. If you watch the latest episodes,
you let guys who are unfiltered, right? Like, I have a filter. I can't be that interesting. I don't just say what's on my – I hold some stuff back, you know. But he has no filter. It's all out there. Like, he'll –
yeah, okay, fine. Stealth Monk, I'll put him down the list.
You don't have to do like a 2.5-hour mega marathon like you always do with me, but, you know, just maybe like a 45-minute one.
Yeah. It's an idea. Okay.
See what the fans think.
I'm sure they're going to want Stealth Monk on. They like the stars. Yeah, he has no teeth in the show.
Yeah, well, he has no teeth, so you know.
I mean, I don't mind that, but I think
somebody in the chat mentioned Zygmunt. I think that would be great, but you really gotta get him drinking. He's a different person when he drinks.
I remember your Zygmunt Malta story last time we were on the podcast.
I mean, he was unbelievable. I've never seen anything like it. And I was hanging out with him, or I was playing with him for like 8 hours, and he was sitting next to me, and we were chatting like the whole time. And like he knew who I was, like, because we played a lot online, and he was like asking me stuff about online, playing online with each other and things. So he clearly like he knew who I was. And then in Barcelona, right, a couple months ago, I saw him. I was like, Hillary, what's up? And he just stared at me and just like didn't give me like the time. He was just like, the fuck are you? Like,
really? Really? He gave you a big time treatment, huh?
Major big time. Just like didn't know who I was or had no interest in like saying like hello and just like walked away. I was just like,
so, really?
Yeah.
You ever been big time by anyone else in poker before like that?
Oh, yeah. No, I actually, the biggest one is like, people will like this. This is like, this really angers me actually. So I've known Tom Dwan for a while, like since I was probably like 19 or 20 or something. But we're like, we've never been close. We've never ever been like close friends, but we're like good friends with a lot of the same people. And like, we've just both been around a while and we've like hung out quite a few times. And he always calls me Danny. I'm not like exaggerating. I'm talking like 30 times in a row of me seeing him. He's like, hey, Danny. I'm like, Tom, my name is Donnie. And he says it every fucking time. And Stephanie knows him too. And I would tell her this and she'd be like, no, he doesn't. You're just like being dramatic or something. And she once saw him when she was like coming to meet me in Bellagio. And she was like, oh, hey, Tom. And he's like, oh hey, like how's Danny? And she's like, his name is Donnie. And he just keeps fucking saying it. And I don't know, at this point, it's like, he's doing it to troll me. So yeah, that's the big time, the most big time I ever get.
Hmm. You still talk to, what is there up to? See, he's in Macau.
Oh, I have no fucking idea. I know as much as anyone else does. But I mean, he used to be around all the time. You know, he used to be at tournaments and in Vegas all the time. And I would see him like fairly regular. I mean, one of my really good friends in poker is, or was like one of his best friends. So I would like go to dinner sometimes and see him like pretty regularly.
Hmm. Now he's in the Macau.
No, Manila. It's all in Manila now.
Oh, it's in Manila. It's not in Macau anymore.
Yeah. Everything's in Manila now.
Oh, the Manila Shuffle, obviously, with Jungle Man. Okay.
Yeah. There's all the big games are in Manila now.
Well, we'll leave it on that story then. Well, I look forward to catching up with you again sometime soon, and might see you out in Vegas during December. That sounds like a lot of people are going there, so it sounds like it could be a fun time to go.
Yeah, it's nice. It's like middle, like, you know, a few months after the World Series, nice to go back to Vegas for a little bit. And Vegas in the winter is awesome. The weather's just like perfect.
Also, PCA, I'll see you. I'll go to PCA 100%. So I'll see you in.
Nice. Cool.
Down there. I'm probably going to spend all of my time not playing poker and just drinking and having fun and enjoying going a little on a, what is it? Bahama Girl Grind or something like that? Is that what it's called?
What?
The Bahama Girl Grind.
You mean you're going to go after Bahamian girls or like?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm going to do. Correct.
You don't want to just stay with the American girls on the resort. You're going to like go into town and try to get with the Bahamian girls.
Yes, for sure.
All right. Good luck.
It seems boring just to stick with the American. I've been sticking with the American girls all my life.
I'm not criticizing. That's just not the norm. So I was just clarifying what you were planning on doing. Just now we know.
Yeah. I got to think about it more. I haven't put much thought into it. I just thought about PCA after I asked you about it. So I don't know. We'll see what happens. The midget girl grind. Shut the fuck up, Logic TKO, man. I hate this guy. Midget girl grind. Jesus Christ. All right, Anski, man. Good luck in the streets. If they want to follow along with you on Twitter, they can find you at the real Anski.
At the real Anski.
Correct. Shakespeare. Cowboys. Jesus Christ. And yeah, I'll be back on probably Monday. If not Monday, then Wednesday. And that's it. That's all I got. Guys on YouTube, much love. Thanks for all the comments. Thanks for all the questions. You guys were great. You guys were funny. Some of you were funny. Some of you are funnier than other people. Donnie, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for coming on. Shout out to Stephanie. Good luck with the marriage. I'll be following along through the social media atmosphere and enjoying whatever cool pictures you guys have. So,
thanks a lot. Thanks for having me. Thanks for doing this show. You're the ultimate podcast grinder.
What do you mean?
So many hours. It's amazing. You never get tired, huh?
I would do more, but okay. Let's talk about this real quick. I feel like I'm doing a disservice to the guests I have on when I have on so many guests, because what happens is you do like 3 in a week. That's a lot for people to watch. So the people who are a little bit less known, they don't like, they're like, some people are just like, well, I'm not going to watch that person. I don't know who they are. Whereas if I space them out, then people are like, well, I haven't seen a podcast in a while. So I'm going to watch that person to figure out more about them. So I would be doing 5 a week. If I like, I can definitely do 5 a week. I have the list I have now is huge that I want to do. And I feel genuinely bad that some people I've told that I'm going to have on and I just haven't had them on for a while. So, and you know, I genuinely feel terrible about it because I want to have everyone on, but you know,
it's impressive. Good job.
Thank you, Poppy. Much love, man. Appreciate All right, guys, we're out. Peace. Later. See ya. Alina, Alina Antilia, give me a shout out. What's up, Alina? All right.
Peace.